Доброе утро. Good morning to the Board of Elections, Campaign Finance Board, members of the committee, advocates, press, and most importantly, to those of you who are here and watching in the audience at home. This is the Committee on Governmental Operations. I'm the chair, Ben Kallos. You can tweet me at Ben Kallos. We are joined this morning by Councilmember Joseph Borelli, Mark Levine, as well as Councilmember Mark Traeger, who has brought so many people from his district. And welcome. This is the biggest, most attendance we've gotten. And we've also achieved another goal of this committee, which is we wanted to make it more accessible and actually have it translated in another language before the end of the term. Did not expect it to be Russian, but I am glad nonetheless. I really want to thank Mark Traeger, because this is an issue we've been working on for a very long time and should not have needed a hearing. But now that we are having a hearing, hopefully we can get this resolved. I'd also like to recognize that we're joined by Councilmember Matthew Eugene, who we sit next to at each and every stated session. And he's got some great legislation here today, which I'll go into later. Today we're holding a hearing on 5 bills and 6 resolutions related to improving voter participation in elections. This has been a top priority for this committee, and we recognize the need for improving voter participation. We held a hearing in March of last year and again this past October on legislation aimed at addressing the civic engagement crisis facing our city. The bills in March 2014 include my bill introduction 659, which establishes a voter information portal to allow registered voters to see their voter histories, find their poll sites, track and request absentee ballots, and verify their voter registration status. This legislation was actually improved by the committee process and most notably by contributions from Councilmember Mark Levine. That bill, which we expect to pass very soon, will lay the groundwork for some of the civic engagement methods we heard last October and will hear today. Fortunately, fostering greater civic engagement is also a top priority of Speaker Melissa Mark Viverito, as she highlighted in her State of the City speech earlier this month. Today's legislation seeks to empower voters by ensuring that they are able to easily access and easily understand valuable information about elections. You need me to hold on? Yes. If you are having difficulty hearing the translation, please raise your hand. We're going to just, we're pausing briefly. We have a large group of folks who are Russian speaking only, which is one of the resolutions that we had. So we're just pausing while we make sure translation is working. We're going to recess for about 5 minutes while we get the translation working.
Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. This is a test. Testing 1, 2, 3. Test, test. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. This is a test. Test. 1, 2, 3. Test. Test. Test.
We are back from recess and thank everyone for their cooperation during our technical difficulties. Again, our priority is to be accessible. And we again thank Councilmember Traeger and everyone from his district for being here today. And I will ask my wife to teach me more Russian so that next time I can just give it totally in Russian. Proposed introduction 463A, sponsored by Councilmember Vaca, would allow voters to receive email and text message notifications regarding the dates and hours of elections, poll site locations, important deadlines for in-person and mailed absentee voting, and notification of sample ballots. This bill would utilize technology to keep voters more informed and therefore more engaged. This bill would utilize technology to keep voters more informed and therefore more engaged. Organizations like Rock the Vote have been offering this service for years, and it is overdue that New York City takes responsibility for ensuring that no one misses an opportunity to vote because they didn't know when the polls closed or mistakenly went to the wrong poll site. As we seek high-tech ways to ensure everyone knows their poll site information, we must also recognize that many people may not have access to the internet or a mobile phone. Proposed Introduction 62A, sponsored by Councilmember Gorodnik, would require the Board of Elections to post notices on Election Day at poll sites that were in operation in the previous 4 calendar years, but which are no longer in use. It's okay. Introduction 62A, sponsored by Councilmember Gorodnik, would require the posting of notices on Election Day. This will help ensure that voters who made the effort to get to the polls will get their correct polling location. Introduction 848, sponsored by Councilmember Torres, would require the Board of Elections to mail, in August of each year, voter history information to every registered voter in the city. Such information would include for each of the previous 4 calendar years whether such voter was registered to vote and whether such voter voted. Thank you. Voters should know their voting histories are a matter of public record and that some public officials only pay attention to those who vote. Knowing your own voting is a check on the records of the Board of Elections and will give voters the peace of mind that when they cast a ballot, they have proof it was counted. Introduction 504, sponsored by Councilmember Eugene, would require the voter guide published by the Campaign Finance Board to include information about federal, state, and county elections, which will give voters more information prior to Election Day. If you want to just come up to the table, we'll take turns. So grab a seat. Just grab a seat at the testimony table and.
Ari can do it 2 seconds.
Депутат городского совета Мэтью Юджин предложил законопроект, резолюцию, в соответствии с которой справочная информация об избирателях Voters Guide должна включать не только биографию кандидатов на разные должности, но и информацию о местных, штатных и федеральных выборах.
Introduction 504 would also allow voters to opt out of receiving a hard copy of the voter guide and instead access it electronically.
И также избиратели в рамках этой резолюции, предложенной депутатом Мэтью Юджином, смогут получать не только бумажный справочник избирателя, но еще вот диск, как использовать это потом в компьютере и таким образом дополнительно получать информацию обо всех кандидатах.
The down-ballot races, like county elections, usually receive little to no press, so it's important that the voter guide, which may be the only source of information about an election that a voter has, includes this information.
Очень часто местные выборы, особенно локального характера на уровне графства, округов, часто не включаются в информацию Совета по выборам, и поэтому очень важно, чтобы эта информация включалась. И вот эта резолюция предполагает расширить объем информации, который получают люди перед выборами, в том числе о местных выборах всех.
Introduction 255, also sponsored by Councilmember Eugene, who's sitting right here, would require CFP to publish the voter guide not only in English and Spanish, but in the top 7 limited English proficient languages spoken by the population in the city. This will enhance LEP individuals' ability to learn critical information about candidates running to represent them, as well as logistical information about Election Day.
И очень важное предложение тоже депутата Горсовета Мэтью Юджина, чтобы справочник избирателя, который высылается во время выборов депутатов городского совета, мэра, всех городских руководителей и другие городские должности, был не только на английском, китайском и испанском языках, но также на еще 7 языках, наиболее используемых в городе Нью-Йорке, в том числе и на русском.
The committee will also hear 6 resolutions today. Proposed Resolution 232A, which I sponsor, calls the state to consolidate congressional, state, and local primaries, saving taxpayer dollars and preventing voter fatigue.
Сегодня мы также обсуждаем и другие резолюции, в том числе и резолюцию, предложенную председателем комитета депутатом Калласом, который предложил резолюцию о том, чтобы объединить некоторые первичные выборы, в частности, федеральные и местные, чтобы не было такого количества выборов, как, например, в этом году, что 4 раза нужно ходить на выборы. Он предлагает объединить местные и федеральные, в частности, первичные выборы в Конгресс США, чтобы это все было в один день, тогда будет меньше выборов в один год.
Resolution 281A, sponsored by Councilmember Rosenthal, calls on the mayor to create an annual student voter registration day to strengthen our efforts in grooming the next generation of politically engaged New Yorkers. Student voter registration drives are something I've done in my district since before I got elected. They are a fantastic way to get young people registered and ready to vote. Councilmember Rosenthal has taken her program citywide and successfully secured initiative funding for the city's budget.
Депутат Горсовета Розенталь. What's her first name?
Helen.
Helen. Депутат городского совета Хелен Розенталь предложил еще один законопроект, резолюцию, которая может помочь усилить активность студентов в выборном процессе и, в частности, создать базу данных для регистрации именно студентов для участия в выборах, предоставление им больше информации, общей базы данных, где каждый студент будет включен и будет легче регистрировать студентов, например, в колледжах и так далее, чтобы было активнее участие студентов в выборном процессе.
The Young Adult Voter Registration Act, which is already law, requires that students be handed a voter registration form with their high school diploma. Yet we all know this act is not achieving its goal of getting young people registered. A bill I introduced in this committee heard last year will mandate track and compliance of YAVRA and distribution of the forms during class time, but a day still needs to be set aside during the school year to show students how important it is to register to vote, and this resolution would do so.
По сегодняшнему закону во время выпуска из государственных школ, из школ, вместе с high school дипломом выдают регистрационную форму избирателя. Но это особо не работает, и поэтому предложение депутата Хелен Розенталь предусматривает, чтобы регистрировать студентов для голосования даже во время учебных занятий в колледжах, в перерывах. То есть сделать это гораздо более активно, чтобы было больше молодых людей, которые регистрируются и участвуют в процессе голосования.
Resolution 870, sponsored by Council Members Rodriguez and Wills, calls on the state to restore voting rights to parolees. Currently, New York State restores voting rights to individuals with felony convictions only after they finish serving their sentence or are released from parole. Resolution 870 would help parolees reintegrate into society more quickly by restoring their right to participate in the electoral system as soon as they are released from prison.
Резолюция, предложенная депутатами Горсовета Родригесом и Виллс, предусматривает изменить правила участия в выборах людей, которые отбыли наказание за различного рода преступления. По сегодняшним законам это они могут регистрироваться для голосования только после того, как они уже покинули места лишения свободы, прошли сроки вот этих парол и всего остального. Только после этого они могут голосовать, регистрироваться для голосования. Предложенный законопроект предусматривает, чтобы они имели право регистрироваться и участвовать в голосовании сразу после освобождения из тюрьмы.
Resolution 384 is sponsored by Councilmember Levine, a member of this committee, and would actually go a long way towards improving our elections. It's hard for anyone to do a good job when you're asking them to work 16 hours, and currently the BOE is allowed to have poll workers work half-day shifts, but currently force everyone to work shifts of 16 hours or more. It's a day that starts long before 5 a.m. and ends long after 9 p.m.
И еще есть резолюция, предложенная депутатом Горсовета Марком Левиным, он здесь находится, которая хочет упростить работу на избирательных участках. Сегодня средняя смена работника избирательного участка, как правило, 16 часов в день. Приходит в районе 5 часов утра, иногда даже раньше, и уходит иногда в 10 или позже. Резолюция предлагает сделать так, чтобы можно было делать разные смены, чтобы люди работали, например, в 2 смены по 8 часов, и тогда будет намного легче людям работать, и больше будет желающих работать на избирательных участках. They love your
this disqualifies most students and working adults. It also places an undue burden on seniors who may not be available to work such long days. Allowing half-day shifts of 8 hours would bring new dedicated and qualified people into the pool of applicants to do one of the most important jobs on election day.
По мнению депутата Левина, такое изменение правил работы на участках, во-первых, поможет людям, у которых, например, есть дети, у которых есть какие-то другие обязанности, что они не могут 16 часов проводить на избирательном участке, улучшит их работу, 8-часовая смена, а не 16-часовая, и поможет также пожилым людям, которым очень часто тяжело 16 часов находиться на избирательном участке, особенно когда явка избирателей очень высокая.
Proposed Resolution 553A, sponsored by Councilmember Cabrera, calls on the state to implement one of the most effective ways to increase voter turnout, create a period before Election Day for voters to vote in person. Having just one single day to vote has prevented many voters from participating, particularly with non-traditional work schedules, working parents, and those with long commutes to and from work. Early voting would increase access and create more vibrant democracy.
И депутат Горсовета Зулюс Феррар, Кабрера. Депутат Горсовета Кабрера предлагает изменить сегодняшние правила в Нью-Йорке, когда голосование происходит только один день и все. Во многих штатах совсем другая практика. И предлагает Горсовет Нью-Йорка обратиться к легислатуре штата Нью-Йорк, разрешить в штате Нью-Йорк ввести, как во многих других штатах, процедуру досрочного голосования, чтобы люди могли голосовать не только в один день, что создает большие проблемы, давку и очереди, но и досрочно голосовать в другие дни, не только в день выборов, но и ранее.
Next is the resolution you are here for today, Resolution 390A, sponsored by the man of the hour, Councilmember Mark Traeger, calls on New York State to require BOE to provide Russian interpreters at certain poll sites, ensuring that the concerns of the Russian community are heard. I want to thank Councilmember Traeger for his dedication to this issue. My wife and in-laws are native Russian speakers, and we should not let language barriers dissuade someone from voting.
И, наконец, мы все здесь находимся, многие, по крайней мере, находятся, ради главной резолюции сегодняшнего дня, героя сегодняшнего дня, депутата Горсовета Марка Трейгера, первого русскоязычного депутата Горсовета, который предложил резолюцию 390-2014. Эта резолюция предусматривает обращение к легислатуре штата Нью-Йорк о том, что необходимо обеспечить все избирательные участки, где более 5% избирателей русскоязычные, русскоязычными переводчиками, так же, как есть с другими иностранными языками. Да, и супруга депутата Горсовета Кайлоса, которая сегодня ведет все это заседание, она русскоязычная, и у нее, естественно, родители русскоязычные, и он говорит, что он будет брать уроки русского языка у нее.
Thank you for all of Mark Traeger's constituents who have come out. It's a testament to how many people care deeply about this issue, as well as the council members' advocacy for an engagement with the needs of his district.
И огромное спасибо всем, кто сюда пришел, избирателям округа Марка Трейгера, всем, кому не безразлична эта проблема. Огромное вам спасибо, что пришли.
This package of legislation will ease voters' ability to access information, enhance their ability to understand important details, and encourage them to be more civically engaged, which in turn will make our city stronger. I'd like to acknowledge that we've been joined by Council Members Torres, Vaca, and Greenfield, and I'd like to call on Councilmember Traeger to make a statement.
И к нам присоединились депутаты Горсовета Джеймс Вака и известный вам Дэвид Гринфилд.
You can make your statement in English or Russian or both.
English.
Доброе утро. Мне легче говорить по-английски, but I'll say it in English, a little bit of Russian. But спасибо. I want to say first and foremost, спасибо. Thank you to Chair Kallos and the staff and all the members of the Committee on Governmental Operations for holding this hearing on 11 bills which seek to strengthen our democracy by providing the citizens of New York with more and better resources to help them fully exercise their right to vote. I am proud to have introduced Reso 390A, a resolution in support of Assembly Bill 4749, sponsored by Assemblymember Bill Colton, and Senate Bill 1703, an act which would require the New York City Board of Elections to provide Russian interpreters at certain polling locations.
Я рад вас всех приветствовать. Доброе утро. Депутат Трейгер говорит, что сегодня он поддерживает все 11 резолюций, которые должен проголосовать Горсовет об улучшении избирательного процесса, увеличении объема информации для избирателей. И, конечно, главное, это его резолюция номер 398, которую он призывает своих коллег одобрить, и которая поддерживает законопроект, предложенный депутатом Ассамблеи Биллом Колтоном в легислатуре штата Нью-Йорк. Этот законопроект, если станет законом штата при поддержке Горсовета, будет обязывать городскую избирательную комиссию предоставлять, чтобы работали, официально работали русскоязычные переводчики на тех участках, где более 5% избирателей говорит по-русски.
I want to say something here for the record. According to the New York City Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs, the population of Russian speakers with limited English proficiency in New York City exceeds other language groups who are already provided interpreters, such as Korean and Bengali, with approximately 114,000 limited English proficiency Russian speaking, compared to 47,000 limited English proficiency Koreans and 39,000 limited English proficiency Bengalis. So, which means there are more Russian speaking than Bengali and Koreans combined, but yet not one Russian speaker interpreter working at our poll sites.
Депутат Горсовета Марк Трегер подчеркивает, что по данным Офиса мэра по делам иммигрантов, сегодня в городе Нью-Йорке проживает 114 тысяч русскоязычных иммигрантов, которые имеют проблему в общении на английском языке. В то же самое время 47 тысяч испаноязычных иммигрантов говорят... нет, 47, Бенгаль, не, 40, 39 тысяч иммигрантов из Бангладеша в городе Нью-Йорке не имеет хорошего свободного английского языка, и 47 тысяч выходцев из Южной Кореи. При этом, то есть, иными словами, русскоязычных иммигрантов, которые имеют проблемы с английским языком, существенно намного больше, чем представители других иммигрантских групп, имеющих сегодня переводчиков на избирательных участках, и в то же самое время русскоязычных переводчиков на участках не допускается.
The lack of Russian interpreters at polling locations has been a long-standing impediment to the full civic participation of the 10th largest immigrant group in our city. The strong turnout this morning in support of this resolution is a testament to the importance of this issue for the Russian-speaking community. And might I add, in this room here today, we have people who are World War II veterans. We have people here who are Holocaust survivors. We have people here who have sacrificed and lost relatives in defense of freedom and liberty for this country here as well. And I am proud to stand on your shoulders as the grandson to Holocaust survivors and World War II veterans.
Как внук переживших Холокост, Марк Трейгер очень гордится тем, что сегодня в зале находятся ветераны войны, бывшие узники гетто и концлагерей, люди, испытавшие немало невзгод и лишений. Марк Трейгер также и говорит о том, что сегодня явка на эти слушания, почти рекордная в истории Горсовета, показывает, насколько эта тема важна для русскоязычной общины.
I applaud the Board of Elections for providing Spanish, Chinese, Bengali, Korean and Hindi interpreters. However, I am baffled and outraged by their continued refusal to provide Russian interpreters despite repeated requests from the community and elected officials. Russian speakers with limited English proficiency are the third largest limited English proficiency language group in New York City after Spanish and Chinese speakers.
Марк Трейгер говорит о том, что наличие переводчиков с корейского, испанского, китайского, бенгали, хинду, для выходцев из Индии и других переводчиков это замечательно, но отсутствие русскоязычных переводчиков на избирательных участках, где много русскоязычных иммигрантов, не может восприниматься как какое-то ущемление интересов русскоязычных иммигрантов.
Failing to provide linguistic access for Russian speakers potentially disenfranchises over 100,000 New Yorkers, and as the first Russian-speaking member of the City Council and the son of Russian-speaking immigrants, I find this exclusion to be a travesty.
По мнению депутата Горсовета Марка Трейгера, он сын, как вы знаете, русскоязычных иммигрантов из Украины. Отсутствие русскоязычных переводчиков все эти годы на участках, где много русскоязычных избирателей, это означает практически дискриминацию, лишение избирательных прав более 100 тысяч, как минимум, русскоязычных нью-йоркцев. Он считает, что это просто, ну, оскорбление, если хотите.
And might I just say that, for the record, what inspired me to introduce this resolution is a story, is an experience that I personally witnessed, where a Holocaust survivor and World War II veteran, who actually was working as a poll worker at a poll site in southern Brooklyn, was threatened by a coordinator at a poll site because he had the audacity to help assist a Russian-speaking voter which ED they had to go to vote in, because they had no idea which booth they had to go vote in. So all they wanted to do was tell them, you vote there. But because he spoke in Russian, they had the police officer called and tried to forcibly remove him until I was called down to the site. And that is outrageous and unacceptable in America in the 21st century.
Марк Трейгер сказал, что одной из причин, побудивших его предложить эту резолюцию, была история, которую он лично наблюдал на избирательных участках, в частности, на участке в Бенсонхерсте, где был работником участка, бывший узник гетто, я его знаю, Александр Волкович, который начал объяснять пожилому русскоязычному избирателю, куда ему пройти для голосования. Но объяснял он это на русском языке, в результате чего координатор участка вызвал полицию и стал требовать, чтобы этот работник участка покинул помещение и перестал работать за нарушение правил голосования на этом участке.
And we keep hearing reports after reports that during training for poll workers and coordinators, and they wouldn't dare put this in writing because they know that they'll get sued immediately. But we keep hearing reports that people doing trainings for poll workers in Brooklyn are being told that if they speak an unauthorized language at the poll site, other than English, Spanish, or Chinese, that to call a police officer and have the person removed from the poll site.
И мы очень часто слышим о случаях, когда во время подготовки работников избирательных участков на вот этих семинарах публично объявляют инструктора, что если кто-то из работников избирательного участка будет говорить во время выборов на языке, который не разрешен официально властями, а разрешены официально испанский, китайский, корейский, то есть на русском языке, если начнут говорить, то этот работник будет тут же удален с избирательного участка и не сможет получить зарплату за свою работу.
So I want to say that this hearing is historic and a triumph for civic access. I'd like to, again to thank Speaker Melissa Mark Viverito, Chair Kallos, members of this committee. I also want to point out we've been joined by Councilman David Greenfield, who represents also a large Russian-speaking community, and he has been a very, very dear and strong friend of our Russian community, as well as the chair of the Jewish Caucus, Mark Levine, who has been a very big, big friend as well. Of course, Councilman Eugene and all the members here as well. This is the first hearing of its kind where the Russian-speaking community is coming out in full force in support of your rights. This is your country, your city too, and you deserve the benefits that every other group has here in New York City.
Депутат Марк Трейгер отметил, что участвует в сегодняшнем заседании депутат Горсовета Дэвид Гринфилд, большой друг русскоязычной общины, депутат Горсовета Марк Левин, поблагодарил всех своих коллег, которые сегодня здесь присутствуют, и напомнил, что это сегодня первые публичные слушания в Горсовете Нью-Йорка, на которых русскоязычная община пришла в таком количестве для защиты своих прав. И он сказал, что это исторический день, что это не только наша страна, но это еще и наш город.
Спасибо большое. I am ready to get this hearing started. Thank you. Шабилья здоровья.
Сейчас слушания начинаются.
We want to thank Ari Kagan for serving as a translator. We're going to go over to our paid translator, and if she needs a break, we'll switch back. I'd like to now call on Councilmember Eugene to make his opening statement. In Russian, please.
Thank absolutely. I'm going to speak only Russian today.
And just thank make you. Sure to give the translator a chance to jump in. Yes.
Thank you so very much. Good morning, everyone. Good morning.
Доброе утро всем. Доброе утро.
I would love to speak Russian this morning, but unfortunately today I cannot, but I will make sure that I learn Russian for the next time. And
он не выучил русский язык сегодня или некоторые фразы, но он уверен, что в следующем разу он подготовится.
I'm Councilmember Matthew Eugene, and it is a pleasure for me to be here today. I'd like to thank Chairman Ben Kallos of the Committee on Government and Operation, and also all my colleagues who introduced important legislation for their effort to bring positive and very important reform to government agencies. Thank you, Chairman Kallos, and to all my colleagues, thank you very much.
And thank you. Благодарит своих коллег за то, что они все находятся тут.
And thank you, Chair Kallos, for your leadership.
И спасибо, что вы здесь.
It is a pleasure for me to discuss my two bills, Intro 255 and Intro 504. Because I'm confident they will empower voters of all ages.
Can you repeat that? I'm sorry.
It is a pleasure for me to discuss my two bills.
Что он находится здесь и предоставляет свои услуги для всех возрастов, людей всех возрастов для вас.
Intro 255 and Intro 504.
Закон 2, 2.
Intro 255.
255.
And Intro 504.
504. Закон.
Because I'm confident that will empower voters of all ages.
Потому что он уверен, что это empowers.
We are in the midst of preparing for a presidential election. And so we are being bombarded with ads and talk about voting.
Сегодня они будут говорить... I'm confused. I'm sorry. Can you please... Yeah. I'm sorry.
I said we are in the midst of preparing the presidential election.
Can you come here, please? I'm sorry. I have difficulties to understand what's going on right now.
Mr. Chair, can I fill in after that?
Why don't we wait the translation?
That's fair. Let me finish.
So, you want Ari to do it? Or?
Yeah. So,
okay. Ari, if you could continue.
Okay.
Thank you very much. We are in the midst of preparing the presidential election.
Мы находимся в разгар президентской кампании в США.
And so we are being bombarded with ads and talk about voting.
И нас забрасывают рекламами и разговорами о том, как важно голосовать.
But our local elections directly impact us. And we must encourage our residents to vote in all elections.
Но мы просто обязаны сделать все возможное, чтобы наши граждане голосовали не только на президентских, но и на местных, городских выборах.
Voting is an important right, but New Yorkers, voters are turned out is being very minimal.
Голосование, это право голоса, это очень важное право любого гражданина США. Но, к сожалению, возможности часто нью-йоркцев, граждан США, очень ограничены, минимальны.
We must examine our policies and do whatever it takes to make voting easier for the men and women in our diverse city.
Мы должны сделать все возможное, чтобы мужчины и женщины, живущие в нашем городе, имели возможность голосовать и сделать это голосование как можно более удобным.
My bill, Intro 255 and Intro 504, would help empower voters.
Мои резолюции сделают все возможное, чтобы дать больше прав избирателям.
And Intro 255 would require the voter guide published by the New York City Board of Election to be published in at least 7 other languages and the type of language spoken in the city of New York in addition to English and Spanish.
Резолюция, предложенная депутатом Горсовета Мэтью Юджином, предполагает, чтобы справочники избирателя, которые высылаются перед выборами всем избирателям, были опубликованы не только на английском, испанском, и китайском языках, но также еще на 7 языках, наиболее распространенных в городе Нью-Йорке, в том числе на русском языке.
Intro 504 will require the voter guide published by the New York City Board of Election to include information about contested federal, state, and county election, in addition to requiring that the voter guide information be available online.
Вторая резолюция, предложенная депутатом Горсовета Мэтью Юджином, предполагает, чтобы справочник избирателя включал не только биографию кандидатов на выборные должности, но и подробную информацию о самих выборах на городском, местном и других уровнях. И также все были даты там и подробная информация, как и где голосовать, на каком избирательном участке и был адрес этого участка.
By providing information to New Yorkers and by doing so in their preferred language, we are giving all New Yorkers an equal opportunity to vote.
И сделав вот такие изменения, мы сделаем все возможное, чтобы все нью-йоркцы в нашем городе, где так много различных рас, национальностей и языков общения, чтобы все нью-йоркцы имели возможность понимать, что происходит, какие выборы подходят, и где именно, и как голосовать.
My bills, H.O. 255 and H.O. 504 will encourage people to vote and increase the voting participation, and in turn, their This bill will make our democracy stronger because it will more accurately represent the voices of all people.
Резолюции, предложенные депутатом Мэтью Юджином, по его мнению, увеличат участие избирателей в этом важном процессе голосования, увеличат число иммигрантов, которые будут голосовать, и упростят процесс голосования, увеличат объем информации, которую мы получаем перед выборами.
Thank you very much again, Mr. Chair, and to all my colleagues who introduce important legislation to make reform in the voting system in New York City. Thank you very much.
Огромное спасибо председателю нашего комитета, депутату Келлосу, и всем моим коллегам за возможность предложить эти резолюции и участвовать в сегодняшних слушаниях.
Next up is Councilmember Jimmy Baca.
Следующим будет выступать депутат городского совета из Бронкса Джимми Вака.
Thank you. My bill, Intro 463, would require the Board of Elections to send email and text message notifications to city voters who provide their email address or mobile phone number.
Резолюция, которую предложил депутат Горсовета Джеймс Вака, предусматривает, чтобы городская избирательная комиссия в канун выборов посылала электронное послание, email или текстовое послание, text message, на сотовый телефон тем избирателям, которые при регистрации указали номер своего сотового телефона или указали свой адрес электронной почты.
In brief, the kind of information that my bill would require to be pushed out to voters would be one. Reminders 10 days in advance and on election day of the election for which the voter is eligible and the poll site location.
За 10 дней до выборов этот законопроект предусматривает, чтобы избиратели получали по имейлу, по электронной почте или текстовое послание, где будет рассказываться, во-первых, как день выборов и адрес избирательного участка, куда нужно прийти голосовать. И приходить это будет из официальной организации Board of Elections.
Notification of in-person absentee voting and the deadline to mail an absentee ballot.
И также условия голосования с помощью бюллетеней для досрочного голосования. И также будет по имейлу присылаться и сам этот бюллетень для досрочного голосования.
And lastly, notification of the availability of a sample ballot online available in all of the languages in which the Board of Elections publishes its election notices that are sent by mail.
И также по электронной почте будет приходить образец избирательного бюллетеня со всей информацией и инструкциями, как голосовать.
Thank you.
Спасибо.
Our next sponsor, Mark Levine.
Следующий депутат городского совета Марк Левин, председатель группы депутатов евреев Горсовета.
Спасибо. Доброе утро. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm pleased to say a few words on behalf of resolution number 384, which would urge the Board of Elections to create an option for poll workers to work half-day shifts.
Резолюция, которую предлагает депутат Горсовета Марк Левин, упрощает работу на избирательных участках. Номер резолюции 384, она предусматривает впервые в истории города Нью-Йорка, что была восьмичасовая рабочая смена. Такой вариант был. 8 часов работать на избирательном участке.
We cannot overstate just how important poll workers are to smooth running elections, but we're asking these hardworking men and women to work shifts of 15, 16, 7 hours, really a brutal length for anyone to work.
Невозможно недооценивать огромную важнейшую работу сотрудников, которые в день выборов работают на избирательном участке. Но это тяжелейший труд, и мы заставляем людей очень часто работать по 15, иногда по 16 часов в сутки, что, по мнению депутата Марка Левина, совершенно недопустимо. И он хочет предложить вариант, чтобы люди могли работать посменно, и одна смена была 8 часов.
It's easy to understand that at the end of a long day, a day that begins in many cases at 5 a.m., poll workers would not be at the top of their game, and it would make it more difficult for them to flawlessly administer voting in their poll site.
И я думаю, вы сами знаете, как тяжело, особенно в конце рабочего дня, в конце дня выборов, людям, которые отработали по 15-16 часов, сконцентрироваться, сфокусироваться, а потом еще подсчет голосов идет, и возможны различные проблемы и нюансы, и этого можно будет избежать, если смена будет не 16 часов, а по 8 часов.
And then the most critical hour of the day comes after the polls are closed at 9 p.m. when the votes are tallied in the poll site. And that is the moment when poll workers will be experiencing maximum exhaustion.
И как назло, именно после 9 часов вечера, когда участки закрыты, когда все уже очень устали и отработали по 15 часов, по 16 часов, именно это самое главное время, когда нужно считать голоса, а люди уже очень-очень устали.
The pattern of voting through the day is such that there is a big rush in the morning before people go to work or before they drop off their kids at school, and there's a rush in the afternoon and evening as people are picking their kids up from school or returning from work.
Наиболее высокая явка избирателей уже доказана в утренние ранние часы, когда дети идут в школу или когда родители едут на работу, и днем, когда забирают детей со школы, и вечером, когда люди идут с работы. Это три наибольшие пик работы людей, которые работают на избирательных участках.
It would be very easy to have a shift change midday when voting is light, so that one shift could work 8 hours, a full day's work, through the morning rush. You could have a shift change midday, second shift could work another 8 hours, a full day in its own right.
Поэтому абсолютно логично иметь две смены с 5 утра до часу дня. Час дня — это время, когда обычно очень slow, очень медленно все идет, и не так уж много избирателей. И с часу до 9, например. То есть это намного упростит работу людям, которые в этот день сталкиваются с избирателями, работают так много на избирательном участке.
This would not only assure that poll workers are fresh during the critical evening rush voting period, as well as during the time when votes are tabulated after 9 o'clock.
Это позволит, чтобы люди были бодрыми, энергичными, и имели максимальный объем внимания к избирателям и к подсчету голосов. И причем не только утром, не только днем, но и вечером, в важный период, когда именно подсчитываются голоса после 9 вечера.
But it would also open up the positions of poll workers to people who simply are not able to do the work today because of the length of the 16 and 17 hour day.
И заодно нам станет легче набирать сотрудников избирательных участков, потому что далеко не все могут проводить по 16 часов в день на избирательном участке, а по 8 часов многие смогут это делать.
Senior citizens who are eager to work, who have the potential to be outstanding poll workers, but simply are not able to work a 17 hour day, understandably.
Многие очень замечательные работники избирательных участков иногда прекращают работать в последующие годы и в следующие выборы только потому, что они считают, что работать по 16, по 17 часов – изнурительный труд, и это просто невозможно выдержать. Они прекращают работать впоследствии и больше не регистрируются работниками участков в будущем.
And young people, students, college students, who also would be eager and capable workers, but may have class in the morning or afternoon, could easily handle a half-day shift, but cannot be there for a full 17 hours.
И предложение депутата Левина упростить ситуацию со студентами вузов, потому что они смогут работать по 8 часов в день, а потом посещать занятия или утром, или вечером. Это гораздо упростит, будет гораздо больше желающих работать среди студентов вузов.
For all these reasons, I want to encourage my colleagues to support Resolution 384, which would call on the Board of Elections to create an option for half-day shifts. Really, they should still be called full-day shifts. They are full 8-hour shifts. So that we have poll workers at their freshest throughout the day, and so that we open up this job to important new populations.
И поэтому я призываю всех моих коллег по городскому совету одобрить мою резолюцию, ее номер 384, и она вводит впервые в истории города Нью-Йорка 8-часовую смену для работы на избирательных участках. Это упростит ситуацию на участках, и это поможет, чтобы все работники избирательных участков всегда были бодрыми, энергичными и утром, и вечером.
Thank you, Chair Kallos, for bringing this resolution to our committee hearing today. Thanks to all of you for joining us. And I want to urge my colleagues to support this important resolution.
Огромное спасибо председателю этого комитета Бену Келлосу и всем моим коллегам, а также всем, кто сегодня присутствует на этих важных слушаниях.
Спасибо, Ари. Thank you.
I want to thank our committee counsel, Smita Deshmukh, policy analyst Lori Wen, finance analyst James Sabuti, legislative director Paul Westrick for their work on today's hearing.
И также хочет депутат Келлос хочет поблагодарить всех сотрудников Горсовета Нью-Йорка, которые сегодня помогают проводить эти непростые публичные слушания, всему техническому персоналу и всем, кто сегодня работает от Горсовета Нью-Йорка, чтобы эти публичные слушания были успешными.
So I just want to go over some quick timeline pieces. In order to accommodate our large audience today, we're going to have Board of Elections come up as our first panel. We will then have questions from council members. We will then have a panel just on the Russian interpreter resolution. So that will probably take us to about 12:30. And then we will then take our third panel of Campaign Finance Board. And then around 1 o'clock-ish, we will get to the good government groups. So I just want to apologize to the good government groups and the Campaign Finance Board and thank all of them for their cooperation. Our hope is that we can deal with the part of the agenda that requires translation first, and then once we're on to the rest of the agenda, things should run more smoothly.
So Board of Elections will be first? Board of Elections will be first. Okay, and then people will be able to testify?
And we have 4 current signed up.
Okay. Сейчас перед вами выступят представители Board of Elections, городской избирательной комиссии, которые расскажут, что они будут делать в этом году с выборами, как они смотрят на все эти резолюции, после чего смогут выступить те, кто записался в выступление.
We'd like to now ask Mike Ryan and Don Sando from the New York City Board of Elections. And Mike, we're going to ask you to please go no longer than 10 minutes and then just work with our professional and volunteer translation.
Okay.
Выступает Майкл Райан, исполнительный директор городской избирательной комиссии Нью-Йорка. Your name?
Дон Сандау.
Right. Yes. Она работает заместителем Майкла Райана.
And before you begin, if you could please raise your right hand. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions?
I do.
Thank you.
Ready to begin? And there's going to be a translation, is correct? Chair Kallos and members of the New York City Council on Committee on Governmental Operations, my name is Michael Ryan. I am the executive director of the Board of Elections in the City of New York. And I am joined by the board's deputy executive director, Ms. Sandow, seated to my left.
Здравствуйте. Мое имя Майкл Райан. Я исполнительный директор городской избирательной комиссии Нью-Йорка. И я со мной вместе моя коллега по городской избирательной комиссии. И я хочу высказать свою обеспокоенность, свои проблемы в связи с возможным принятием резолюции Горсовета номер 62A, 463A и 848.
For the purposes of clarification, I'm going to be limiting my remarks today to the intros that directly affect the Board of Elections. The Board is offering no commentary, but is prepared to answer questions with respect to the resolutions or any intros that may affect other agencies that will be testifying later.
Я буду сегодня очень ограничен в своих высказываниях и комментариях и буду комментировать только те резолюции, которые, по моему мнению, радикально влияют на работу городской избирательной комиссии.
As usual, I would like to thank Chair Kallos for the opportunity to testify here today. And without further ado, I will be going into my prepared remarks.
Сейчас я перейду к заранее заготовленному своему выступлению. Еще раз благодарю депутата Келлоса за возможность выступить сегодня здесь.
Generally, the New York State Constitution, Article 8, Section 2C(i), provides that every local government may adopt laws relating to its property affairs or government, so long as that those laws do not conflict with the state constitution or any general law of the state. I'm sorry, that's Article 9, not Article 8.
Если говорить в целом, то Конституция штата Нью-Йорк, статья 9, секция 2CI, требует, чтобы каждое местное правительство принимало только такие законы, которые имеют прямое отношение к имуществу, делам или правительству, если они никоим образом не входят в конфликт с Конституцией или законами штата Нью-Йорк.
Article 2, Section 8 of the New York State Constitution establishes the Board of Elections as an independent body set forth to honestly administer elections, including those for local elected officials.
И в частности, Конституция штата Нью-Йорк, статья 2, секция номер 8, а также соответствующие законы штата Нью-Йорк, в частности, закон о выборах, предусматривают, что городская избирательная комиссия Board of Elections является независимым агентством, которое делает все возможное для того, чтобы честно и справедливо управлять выборами. Независимое агентство.
In addition, for those that are familiar and for those who are unfamiliar with the board of, with the New York State election law, it is a comprehensive body of law that prescribes very specific rules and regulations under which the board must operate. And in addition, we must also operate pursuant to the rules set forth by the New York State Board of Elections, which is essentially our governing body.
И нужно учитывать, что существует огромное количество законов и правил, которые установлены штатом Нью-Йорк, которые требуют от городской избирательной комиссии все эти законы соблюдать. Мы действуем только в рамках этих законов.
Local governments have limited authority with respect to the Board of Elections, most notably with respect to the appointment of commissioners under 3-204 and the allocation of funds under 4-136, both of the New York State election law.
Местное правительство, в частности, городское правительство Нью-Йорка, имеют определенное влияние на работу городской избирательной комиссии. В частности, могут назначать руководителей городской избирательной комиссии от каждого района и в целом, и также могут выделять деньги, фонды для того, чтобы проводить выборы.
The New York State courts for at least 75 years have recognized the unique constitutional and statutory status of the Board of Elections for all 62 counties throughout the state.
Здесь нужно учитывать, что на протяжении очень многих лет суды штата Нью-Йорк всегда признавали уникальное конституционное право городской избирательной комиссии действовать именно в рамках законов штата Нью-Йорк.
The primary goal is to ensure a uniform statewide application to protect the fundamental right of suffrage and to ensure the orderly conduct of elections for local, statewide, and federal officers. As such, it is a matter of statewide concern.
Нужно понимать, что речь идет еще раз о законах штата Нью-Йорк, и поэтому локальные все правительства местные, в том числе городское правительство Нью-Йорка, имеют возможность только ограниченно влиять на ход местных выборов и работы избирательной комиссии только в рамках законов штата. Это уникальный статус городской избирательной комиссии. Это сделано для того, чтобы была абсолютно уникальная и абсолютно единая система голосования и работы избирательных участков по всему штату Нью-Йорк.
In my written testimony, you will note that the court has placed restrictions on the influence of local governments over the boards of election throughout the state, and that is a consistent presidential history.
Вы поймете из моего выступления о том, что суды штата Нью-Йорк неоднократно ограничивали возможности местных правительств, в том числе городских правительств, оказывать какое-то влияние на работу городских избирательных комиссий. И все эти судебные решения всегда делали возможным, чтобы все городские избирательные комиссии работали в первую очередь в соответствии с законами штата и ограничивали возможности местных правительств влиять на работу избиркомов.
Most recently in the case of Castine v. Zerlo, decided in 2014, the court precluded a county from imposing its own ethics code upon the local board of elections as violative of sections 1-102 of the election law and section 3-200 subdivision 4.
Например, в 2014 году было решение суда штата Нью-Йорк, которое называется Castine versus Zerlo, которая обязала местное правительство в одном из округов штата Нью-Йорк, что они не могут устанавливать свои собственные правила этики поведения, связанные с различными выборами в этом графстве, в этом округе, независимо от того, как это захотело местное правительство.
The board respectfully submits that intros 62-A, 463-A, and 848 are in conflict with the independent nature of the board's constitutional and statutory authority. The board's opinion is consistent with the state's constitutional and statutory framework.
По мнению представителей городской избирательной комиссии, как минимум три предлагаемые сегодня резолюции нарушают законы штата Нью-Йорк и вмешиваются в конституционные права городской избирательной комиссии. Это резолюция 62A, 463A и 848. Они находятся, по мнению горосбиркома, в прямом конфликте с независимым статусом городской избирательной комиссии.
And that has also been confirmed by the various cases which are contained in our written testimony and have been decided over long period of time in the state of New York.
И эта история давно уже определена судами штата Нью-Йорк во всех судебных решениях, подчеркнуто независимый характер городской избирательной комиссии и приоритет законов штата Нью-Йорк над местными законами в этих вопросах.
That having been said, the board enjoys a very close working relationship with the mayor's administration and the city council as government partners, and we are cognizant of the fact that the city council has certain authority over the board of elections, but more importantly, each member of the city council represents a constituency that allows for the constituency's voices to be heard. So while we differ over direct legal authority, that does not mean that we do not enjoy a good and close working relationship with the city council.
Сказанное мною, говорит Майкл, вовсе не означает, что мы находимся во враждебных отношениях с местным правительством. Наоборот, мы находимся в партнерстве, в сотрудничестве, в дружбе с депутатами городского совета, которые представляют интересы своих избирателей, с мэром города. И мы стараемся делать все возможное, чтобы во время выбора в избирательном участке все проходило благополучно и найти такие варианты, чтобы не выходить, с одной стороны, за рамки законов штата Нью-Йорк, но, с другой стороны, решать те проблемы, о которых сегодня идет речь.
Simply put, the difference lies in whether or not the board must accept a mandate or simply have a good cooperative working relationship that deals with practical suggestions on how to improve the process. Under some instances, we will differ on the former, but I don't think under any circumstances would we differ on the latter.
Я хочу, чтобы меня правильно понимали. Мы говорим в данном случае о том, чтобы нас обязывали что-то делать, заставляли что-то делать, когда мы явно с этим не согласны или когда это противоречит законам штата Нью-Йорк. Но это вовсе не означает, что мы не понимаем или что мы не согласны с тем, почему такие предложения звучат от депутатов городского совета. И мы, с одной стороны, хотим соблюдать букву закона, но, с другой стороны, хотим, прекрасно понимаем пожелания депутатов и будем стараться работать над тем, чтобы упростить процесс голосования.
In the interest of time, we have very specific references in our written testimony with respect to each bill. If the committee so desires, I can dispense with the public reading of those, since it's part of the record, and open the floor up to questions, or I can continue with my testimony as you prefer.
The testimony is on record. Anyone can view it online. Anyone here, if you need a copy, we can give it to you. If we can begin question and answer.
That's fine.
Майкл только что сказал, что все резолюции, против которых возражает Совет по выборам, Горисберком, находятся на веб-сайте сегодня, будут опубликованы официально данные сегодняшних слушаний, и поэтому они считают нужным перечислять полностью тексты всех резолюций. But can I at least, like in one line, say what kind of resolutions the Board of Elections is objecting to? Three resolutions, just in one line, what is what? Not whole resolution, but just in one line. So, but the most important, you're not objecting to the resolution, 1 second, 398. You're not objecting to this resolution.
We're not objecting to any resolution. Okay. We're simply offering no testimony on the resolutions because there is a separate state process that allows us to participate. And if these become state proposals, then we will testify either before the Assembly or the Senate.
Только что объяснил руководитель городской избирательной комиссии, что он не высказывает возражений против тех или иных предложений депутатов. Он просто говорит о том, что в любом случае они подчиняются законам штата Нью-Йорк и являются независимым агентством. И что одно дело, когда им предлагают сотрудничество, партнерство с горсоветом и мэром, другое дело, когда их обязывают что-то делать вопреки законам штата Нью-Йорк, что они просто не могут сделать. И в частности, комментарии, которые предлагаются, касаются трех резолюций, не той резолюции, которую предложил депутат Марк Трегер, но резолюции, которые затрагиваются, например, отправки электронных посланий, текстовых месседжей, например, за 10 дней до выборов, по имейлу, вот то, что мы рассказывали, и на сотовые телефоны. Также о том, что когда именно должны голосовать, досрочное голосование, что это должен быть закон штата Нью-Йорка, а не городская резолюция горсовета. И третья резолюция — это что нужно опубликовать и выставлять информацию о том, когда происходят какие выборы и где результаты, где находится информация о тех или иных избирательных участках, прямо на входе в любые билдинги, которые даже не используются иногда как избирательный участок, чтобы больше люди знали, где именно расположен избирательный участок. Вот это три конкретные резолюции, по которым комментарии есть Совета по выборам, но не резолюция, предлагаемая депутатом Трегером. They wanted to ask questions.
If folks have questions, they should write them down and contact Mark Traeger's office, and we will get them answers.
Нужно только в письменном виде вопросы передавайте офису депутата Горсовета Марка Трегера. Мы их рассмотрим и ответим в рабочем порядке в зависимости от наличия сегодня времени.
And just before we go forward, with respect to Resolution 384 of 2014, I would like to say that the New York State election law already provides for split shifts under Section 3-400, Subdivision 7. We have done a pilot in Brooklyn last year utilizing split shifts, and the commissioners passed their own directive allowing for the board to begin the process of utilizing, and hopefully we'll get a lot of 17-year-old poll workers to try to integrate them into this split shift process. So some of that work has already begun.
Майкл хочет подчеркнуть, что история со сменами по 8 часов, что он говорит, что не обязательно для этого принимать резолюцию горсовета, что уже сегодня городская избирательная комиссия работает в этом направлении с горсоветом и с мэром, чтобы внедрить такую практику, что люди, которые не могут 16 часов проводить на избирательном участке в качестве работников, имели возможность, скажем, только на 8 часов. И он говорит, что необходимости в дополнительной резолюции горсовета на эту тему не требуется.
So I'm going to just ask one quick question. I appreciate the quick testimony, and I just wanted to ask a quick yes-no question of does
the lightning round?
Lightning round. Does the Board of Elections of the City of New York receive funding from the city or state?
Вопрос от председателя комиссии, депутата Келлоса. Получает ли городская избирательная комиссия Нью-Йорка фонды, деньги от городского совета Нью-Йорка и от властей штата Нью-Йорк? От кого получает деньги городская избирательная комиссия города Нью-Йорка?
You can answer with да or нет.
duh, end. We do by state mandate. So the source of the funding is from the city of New York, correct?
Да, все деньги, которые мы получаем, приходят из городской казны. Но они приходят из городской казны, потому что существует на эту тему закон штата Нью-Йорк.
And is the Board of Elections an unfunded state mandate, or is it something that is funded by the city and therefore... So yes, is the Board of Elections an unfunded state mandate?
I wouldn't characterize it that way. It is part of the structure of the state... both constitutionally and statutorily for many, many years, and we get our funding from the city of New York. That is correct.
Вопрос был еще раз. Считаете ли вы, что городская избирательная комиссия работает в рамках необеспеченного деньгами мандата штата Нью-Йорк? Ответ был, на самом деле, да, мы получаем все полностью, 100% финансирования только из казны города Нью-Йорка, но мы в то же самое время подчиняемся законам штата Нью-Йорк, которые и обязали город выделять эти деньги.
I would just so with that said, I respectfully disagree with the board's testimony for the record, and will now pass over.
Депутат горсовета Келлос считает, что он категорически не согласен с выступлением представителя избирательной комиссии, и получая полностью финансирование из городской казны, фактически горосбирком не хочет прислушиваться, не хочет принятия никаких резолюций горсовета на тему о выборах или на работе на избирательных участках. И председатель только что выразил свое несогласие с выступлением руководителя городской избирательной комиссии. Фира, вопросы только в письменном виде. Only in writing. But in writing. In writing.
The audience can, if you have questions, you can write them down, pass it to the sergeant at arms, and it will be passed to Councilmember Traeger.
Все вопросы только в письменном виде передавать туда, и эти вопросы будут переданы депутату горсовета Трейгеру, и он ответит на эти вопросы. They have some questions to the Board of Elections.
I'm going to ask questions.
What they should do is write their questions in English or Russian, pass them to the sergeant at arms, who will raise his hand, and then he will bring them up to Councilmember Traeger.
Все вопросы только в письменном виде, не в устном виде, и все вопросы передавать, пожалуйста, туда, иначе вас могут удалить из этого зала заседаний. В письменном виде, пожалуйста, вопросы передавайте вот людям. Называется он сержант in arms, так что он еще и вооруженный, и он будет передавать все эти вопросы депутату горсовета Марку Трейгеру. Можно писать на русском языке, все переведут и ответят.
And Mark Traeger will decide which questions to ask now, which ones he will forward on for answering later. And my counsel also asked that I caution that the Board of Elections, who are testifying now, do not have a position on the Russian translator resolution, so they will not be able to speak to that.
Очень важно, что только что отметили, что городская избирательная комиссия официально заявляет, что она не имеет никакой позиции по резолюции, предложенной депутатом Марком Трейгером, о переводе, об обязательном наличии русскоязычных переводчиков на избирательных участках. Это хорошая новость.
Okay.
Maybe by the end. Может быть. Может быть.
Okay.
В письменном виде. Just.
Я сейчас буду вопросы.
Just in writing. Только okay. В письменном виде.
So, good morning, Director Ryan and Deputy Director Sando, and thank you, Chair Kallos, for giving me the time this morning. And I am fully cognizant that even though the City of New York predominantly funds the Board of Elections, the state does have greater authority. That is why this is a resolution. But it's very germane to this council because, first of all, New York City probably has the heaviest concentration of Russian-speaking residents in New York. And quite frankly, this is a city administration and a city council that is boasting, rightfully so, that we are an inclusive city and that we are a city for all. And I think that this is very germane to this committee and to this council and to this hearing right now.
Депутат горсовета Марк Трейгер спрашивает у представителя избирательной комиссии, говорит, что мы все это понимаем, что вы сказали, и именно поэтому у нас не закон мы предлагаем, не законопроект, а резолюцию, как бы декларацию, призывающую власти штата Нью-Йорк поддержать вот те или иные инициативы. Это не, мы никого не заставляем, но мы призываем. И, конечно, эта резолюция будет иметь весомую силу, но это резолюция. То есть это не закон, а резолюция.
Ari, I would just add that if we did have that power, I would absolutely be pushing a law requiring it.
Он говорит, что если бы городской совет имел такую власть над городской избирательной комиссией, тогда бы это был бы вообще законопроект и закон, обязывающий все это делать городскую избирательную комиссию. Но так как горсовет такой власти не имеет, это только резолюция, обращение к властям штата Нью-Йорк принять такое правило. И депутат горсовета Марк Трегер также говорит, что мы живем в столице мира, где очень много разных общин, и он считает просто необходимым принять его
And I want to say for the record, someone from the state, at least one person from the state is here. We have been joined by Assembly Member Pamela Harris, who represents the 46th Assembly District, who is a historic candidate and historic official, who happens to be the first African-American elected in a white majority district, garnering over 70% of the Russian vote in her district.
И к вопросу о властях штата к нам присоединилась депутат Ассамблеи штата Нью-Йорк Памела Харрис, которая во время последних выборов получила более 70% голосов русскоязычных иммигрантов и представляет огромную русскоязычную общину в 46-м избирательном округе.
And council member, just before, if I happen to, in the course of my answer, if I'm going too far and you need me to stop, just okay. Give me a wave, so far, you know, so that we make sure everybody understands what's happening.
Okay, so I'll ask some questions now. Director Ryan, is there anything legally barring you right now from hiring Russian-speaking interpreters at poll sites with large Russian-speaking populations?
Вопрос к Майклу Райану. Сегодня хватает ли у вас властных полномочий? Нужны ли вам дополнительные законы города, штата, страны для того, чтобы на избирательных участках в день выборов законно работали русскоязычные переводчики? Не сотрудники, а переводчики официально работали.
Our concern, and it's much more of a concern, the impediment presently is a practical one more than a legal one. While under the Federal Voter Rights Act, Section 203 and 204C, we are mandated to provide language assistance when there is a greater than 5% by county. However, that is according to the last census. So the data that we are allowed to look back to right now goes back to 2010, and we're 6 years into that cycle.
Во-первых, нужно сказать, что проблема наша даже не столько в каких-то юридических проблемах, сколько в различного рода технических проблемах. Но начнем с того, что мы руководствуемся федеральным законом о защите прав избирателей, который предусматривает предоставление услуг избирателям в день выборов на участках на их родном языке, если минимум 5% этих избирателей говорят на другом языке, не на английском. И это правило соблюдается в Нью-Йорке. Больше, чем 5% населения Нью-Йорка на русскоязычном. Но в то же самое время цифры подсчета населения, которые должны использоваться при этом, это цифры переписи населения 2010 года. А у нас на дворе сейчас 2016 год. То есть мы находимся посередине процесса между двумя переписями населения, и непонятно данными какой переписи нужно руководствоваться.
So plans and funding are typically predicated by mandates. And that's where the rubber really meets the road for us. And there are other situated groups that would make a similar case to the case that the Russian community is making. And then we're in a position of provide for one, provide for all, when we might not be and very likely won't be in the financial position to do that. That having been said, we're happy to work with the city council and with the state legislature to try to overcome some of these hurdles.
Мы опасаемся, что нам просто не хватит финансирования выполнения этой просьбы, этого правила, этих обращений в силу того, что вслед за русскоязычными иммигрантами города Нью-Йорка о таких же переводчиках попросят представители других этнических групп, которых тоже больше 5% населения в тех или иных округах, избирательных округах, более 5%. И мы окажемся в ситуации, когда мы посередине между переписями, получив фонды только, исходя из данных последней переписи, должны будем предоставлять переводчиков на другие языки для огромного количества этнических общин города Нью-Йорка, не только для русскоязычной общины.
So just to be clear on the record, it's helpful just for us to know for the record, There is nothing legally prohibiting you right now from hiring Russian interpreters at certain poll sites. It's a simple.
То есть сегодня
ничего. Right. There is no statutory prohibition, but we do believe that if we cross a certain threshold, we may find ourselves in a position of equal protection clause arguments being made by other groups, and that's the slope that we're on.
Well, okay.
Let me translate. It's very, very important. This is very important.
Absolutely.
Вопрос был, Марко Трегер, значит, вы говорите, что сегодня не нужно никаких новых законов для того, чтобы на участках, где много русскоязычных избирателей, официально работали от Board of Elections русскоязычные переводчики. Вам вообще не нужно никаких новых законов. Так ли это? Ответ был, да, это так. Нам никаких новых законов не нужно. Но мы можем оказаться в ситуации, когда нам на это просто не хватит финансовых средств. Потому что как только мы это сделаем для русскоязычной общины, мы должны будем это делать в некоторых районах, например, для выходцев из Гаити на их языке, и для, в других районах для выходцев из других стран, и нам просто не хватит финансирования для найма на работу представителей переводчиков из других этнических общин. Только поэтому мы сопротивляемся вот этому, этой ситуации.
So how do you, Director Ryan, how do you explain hiring interpreters for Bengali and Korean residents while omitting the Russian-speaking population that far exceeds their numbers?
Как же вы объясняете в таком случае наличие на избирательных участках города Нью-Йорка переводчиков с бенгальского языка и с корейского, когда избиратели, говорящих по-корейски и на бенгальском языке в городе Нью-Йорке, вместе взятых в два раза с лишним меньше, чем русскоязычных избирателей?
The practical answer is very simple. For those languages that you just set forth, namely being Chinese, Bengali, Korean, and Spanish, we're required to do so by the limited English proficiency standard set forth in the Federal Voter Rights Act. And so it becomes a question of mandate. And like any other agency, if our mandates expand, we believe at that point we would have a good case for additional resources. It's a mandate issue and a resource issue.
По нашему мнению, это и вопрос законодательный, и вопрос финансирования фондов. Нас просто обязывают, например, законы федеральные предоставлять перевод обязательный на испанский, китайский, корейский язык и какой-то еще. А бенгальский язык – закон штата Нью-Йорк. То есть, да, закон все-таки нужен какой-то штата Нью-Йорк для того, чтобы обеспечить потом ресурсами, фондами, горосберком для найма русскоязычных переводчиков.
So I am fairly certain in the Voting Rights Act it does not specifically state Bengali or Korean.
That's correct.
So how do you then justify them and not the Russian-speaking population?
Депутат Трегер только что сказал, что он абсолютно уверен, что федеральный закон о защите прав избирателей не имеет в своем списке языков бенгальский язык. Как же объяснить, что сегодня есть переводчики с бенгальского, но нет переводчиков с русского языка?
As I set forth earlier, the standard is 5% of the subdivision, 5% of the population of a particular subdivision. So in this particular case, we would say each one of the boroughs would be a subdivision. We don't break it down into individual election districts. That would be a borough-wide, we do break it down into the individual subdivisions. For example, in Manhattan and Brooklyn, not every area is required to have Chinese, although some areas are. So that's how it's broken down. And it's 5% of the political subdivision as established by the census, this last census in 2010. I'm not a demographics expert, but I can tell you just by living that saturations of populations change over 10 years. And there's some call at some point to half-life the census to make it a 5-year census so that we can do updates. But that's not the standards we have right now. The standards are census is every 10 years, and that's how it's established.
Как я уже сказал, говорит Майкл Райан, все это определяется в зависимости от того, где находится 5% того населения, минимум, в том или ином округе или районе, которая не говорит по-английски, и такому населению нужно предоставлять услуги на родном языке. Но это определяется, население, говорящее на том или ином языке, определяется по итогам переписи населения, которая была в 2010 году. Следующая перепись населения в 2020 году. И мы не можем посередине между двумя переписями, говорит он, в 2016 году, сейчас определять, сколько населения в том или ином округе живет, и получать, исходя из этого, финансирование на найм переводчиков.
Let me just say that I don't believe there's a person in this room that came here in the last 5 or 6 years. My family came here from Ukraine in 1979. So the Russian-speaking population is not a new phenomena in New York City or in this country.
Депутат горсовета Марк Триггер сказал, что он вообще не понимает ответы представителей городской избирательной комиссии. В этом зале нет ни одного человека, сказал он, который приехал в Америку в последние 6 лет. Все приехали до последней переписи населения. Семья самого Марка Триггера приехала в 1979 году. И поэтому аргумент, что всех этих людей не было во время прошлой переписи населения в Нью-Йорке, и поэтому невозможно их посчитать, что там 5% и в тех или иных районах говорит по-русски, просто ему абсолютно непонятен этот аргумент.
Councilman, as I said, we are bound by the federal census data. What the federal census data shows are the numbers that we are bound by. And I'm certain that if we were not following those regulations, there are federal authorities, as they have done in other jurisdictions throughout the state, that have imposed their will when moments of institutionalized discrimination have occurred. That's not happening in New York City in an official way, but I fully appreciate the practical concerns that you are stating when voters go to the poll sites. The fact that official, you know, discrimination is not occurring doesn't help people when they're trying to vote, and I get that.
Я прекрасно понимаю, говорит Майкл Райан, что тот факт, что нет официальной дискриминации, никому не упрощает ситуацию, никого не объясняет и никого не успокаивает. Я все это понимаю. Мы руководствуемся исключительно федеральными и штатными законами, и федеральные законы от нас требуют предоставлять перевод только на те языки, о которых я уже говорил.
So, the Voting Rights Act that you mentioned, I understand that Asian American is one of the groups that the census will factor in.
Actually, it's Asian Indian.
Asian Indian.
Asian okay. Indian, yes.
So, as a former history and geography teacher, it is my understanding that the former Soviet Union covered both Europe and Asia. So their federal rights are being violated when they're not being provided translation when they enter a poll site.
По мнению депутата городского совета Марка Триггера, он говорит, что спросил, какой, по вашему мнению, федеральный закон требует языки каких государств и каких континентов, материков покрывает федеральный закон о защите прав избирателей. На что Майкл Райан ответил, такие-то, такие-то, и в том числе он сказал азиатские языки. На что Марк Триггер сказал, что он хорошо изучал географию в школе, и бывший Советский Союз покрывает не только европейскую территорию, но и азиатскую территорию, поэтому выходцы из бывшего Советского Союза вполне попадают под эту федеральную юрисдикцию для выходцев из Азии тоже. И выходцев из Средней Азии тоже.
Councilman, all I can say is, right now, as we speak, Russian is not mandated under the limited English proficiency provisions that we follow. So that doesn't mean that no assistance has been given to the Russian community. There is provisions of the state law that require us to publish certain materials in Russian under 3-506 of the New York State election law. And as well, we put a lot of translated materials on our website in the Russian language. What we're talking about here is what happens at the poll site. And I would say as an interim measure, you want to go?
Yeah, yes, it's important what
yes,
you say.
Yes, absolutely.
Все, что я могу сказать, уважаемый депутат Марк Триггер, о том, что федеральный закон сегодня не включает русский язык в те языки, на которых обязаны быть переводчики на избирательных участках. Но в то же самое время есть закон уже штата Нью-Йорк, благодаря которому мы на нашем веб-сайте городской избирательной комиссии ввели перевод на русский язык, и на этом веб-сайте любой желающий сегодня может выйти на веб-сайт городской избирательной комиссии Board of Election, и есть там вариант перевода на Russian, на русский язык. Кроме того, сказал Марк Райан, что мы делаем все возможное, чтобы упростить русскоязычное общение другими способами, помочь. У нас есть работники избирательных участков русскоязычных, и стараемся другими способами все же упростить те трудности, о которых сегодня идет речь.
I have made in my 2.5 years as the executive director numerous appearances on David's and radio. And we've had these types of exchanges back and forth. Many of the questions that are asked here today have been asked on that radio program. And I would like to point out that under Section 8-306 of the New York State Elections Law, which is the section requiring assistance, as an interim measure, individuals that have difficulty with the English language can bring someone to assist them. And I understand that in the moment, that's flipping the obligation, you know, back to the voter. But in those areas where Russian speakers are prevalent, we would be happy to work with anyone to instruct the voters and the people in the community to have someone available to provide assistance. And that is under 8-306 subdivision 3. And then I want to read something because I think it's important.
Майкл Райан говорит, что он неоднократно выступал на Дэвидсон радио, и были аналогичные вопросы много-много раз ему от русскоязычных избирателей. И он всегда на них отвечал о том, что нету федерального закона, обязывающего предоставлять русскоязычных переводчиков, но всегда можно найти вариант, при котором человек, имеющий проблемы с английским языком, чтобы были варианты, при котором можно ему оказать помощь с условием, если есть русскоязычные работники на избирательном участке, чтобы они могли оказать какую-то помощь, или чтобы этот избиратель пришел на участок с кем-то, кто ему оказал бы помощь в переводе с английского на русский. С собой имеет право взять.
So 8-306 subdivision 3. Any voter who requires assistance to vote by reason of blindness, disability, or inability to read or write. Now, there is no qualifier after that. So I would say if someone cannot read or write English or one of the other languages that's provided on the ballot, they would qualify under this statute, can get assistance from a person of their choice, provided that that person is not somebody who works for their employer or who works or is a representative of the union. And that's a way to get some assistance in the interim, while some of these other legislative difficulties may be worked out.
Закон штата Нью-Йорк разрешает людям, которые имеют ту или иную инвалидность, глухие, слепые, имеют другие инвалидности, не умеют читать и понимать по-английски, разрешает приводить с собой членов семей, людей, которые, с которыми они даже работают вместе или которые им оказывают помощь на дому, разрешает их приводить с собой на избирательный участок для оказания этой помощи.
Mr. Ryan, with all due respect, this council and myself will not advocate for a separate and unequal system. What's good for one group is good for all groups, and I believe that the equal protection of these residents and of their neighbors and friends are being disenfranchised and are being violated. This should not be the onus on the voter. The onus is on the government to make sure that access is equal and protected for all citizens. And so I respectfully reject the notion that they have to come up with a plan of action when they come to vote. Quite frankly, I would argue that they are a protected group. And I still didn't really get an answer. So you're saying that there's nothing that mandates you to hire Russian-speaking interpreters, but yet you're also saying there's nothing that prohibits you from hiring Russian-speaking interpreters. So I believe that this is a matter where the government here wants to work with the Board of Elections to get a plan of action underway immediately to be able to hire Russian interpreters, not at every single poll site, But certainly, if you go to Brighton Beach, or if you go to parts of Southern Brooklyn, or parts of Forest Hills, Queens, there are densely pockets of Russian-speaking people. And when I go to the poll sites and see what they are subjected to, it's awful. Which leads me to, it's one of my final questions here. I have a couple more, but I'm just going to try to wrap up.
Can I comment on that?
But let me translate, maybe.
Yeah. I do not want to leave here today giving the impression that the Board of Elections as an entity is at odds with anything that's being suggested. What I'm simply saying is, under our present funding scheme and what we have, the resources that we have available to us, we are unable to do it. I wish you luck in your resolution, and if your colleagues in the state government tell us that they agree with you and there's a statutory mandate, we will follow the statutory mandates. And like we do with a myriad of other things, we will make sure that it gets implemented as well as it can be under the circumstances.
Депутат Горсовета Марк Трегер только что сказал, что он отвергает все объяснения, которые он сегодня услышал. Особенно его возмущает, когда говорят, что это избиратели должны заниматься, создавать план действий. Как же им обходиться в той ситуации, если они что-то по-английски не понимают? Кого они должны с собой приводить? Как они должны выходить из этих ситуаций? Почему, спрашивает Марк Трегер, таких проблем не возникает с выходцами из Бангладеша или других государств? Почему нужно придумывать какие-то сложности и фантазии для выходцев из бывшего СССР? Он отверг все эти аргументы и сказал, что он не понимает, почему русскоязычная община до сих пор находится в таком положении пасынков. И тут же в ответ Майкл Райан ответил, что он не хочет выступать в роли человека, который как бы враг или как бы не согласен со всем этим. Он сказал, что я полностью со всем этим согласен, никакого антагонизма здесь нету, я полностью на вашей стороне. Но, к сожалению, он говорит, у меня руки связаны в первую очередь с вопросами законодательства и вопросами финансирования. Для того, чтобы получить разрешение это делать, и для того, чтобы получить финансирование на русскоязычных переводчиков, по мнению Майкла Райана, нужен еще один закон штата Нью-Йорк.
So, Mr. Ryan, I'm going to wrap up because I know we have some panels here. Can the Board of Elections, or do you have an idea or an estimate of how much it would cost the Board of Elections to hire interpreters at certain poll sites? We're not talking about every poll site in New York City. We're talking about pockets in Southern Brooklyn, pockets in Queens, pockets in Staten Island, maybe Washington Heights, I believe, as well.
Pelham Park.
I'm sorry?
Pelham Park.
Yes, correct. So there are, we're not talking about every single poll site, but there are pockets. Is there an estimate that the agency has drawn up, or can you commit to drawing one up so we all in government know how much cost we're actually talking about?
We would have to work very closely with representatives of that community, since the census data that we have presently doesn't support it, and that's what we rely on. But if there are areas in Brooklyn that you would like to point to that says that you say meet the criteria, it's a very simple analysis when all is said and done. There's some training associated with it, right, which we'd have to get Russian-speaking qualified trainers to do, and then they'd have to pass a test. But in terms of the actual election day cost, it's $200 per day per poll site, maybe times two, depending on the population saturation. So ultimately, the math. I'm sorry, three times three. So it's about, call it on the outside number, $600 per poll site per election event. So like for this year, it would be $2,400 additional per poll site. Provided that we don't have any special elections, and we have seen that those are coming up with more frequency than they had in the past. So we can't always say, but we certainly can work to come up with a good guesstimate.
And respectfully, in a city budget of over $80 billion, those are peanuts.
And quite frankly, you know, the one good thing about sitting here before the committee that participates in establishing the budget, if it becomes a budget hurdle, we could certainly then come back to you and say, we've hit a little bit of a budget hurdle, can you help us out?
Right. Депутат Горсовета Марк Трегер спросил, хорошо, о какой сумме идет речь? О каких космических деньгах идет речь? Сколько же обойдется найм русскоязычных переводчиков на очень ограниченном количестве избирательных участков в тех районах, где живут русскоязычные иммигранты? Ответ Майкла Райана был, это обойдется в $2,400 на каждом участке, где много русскоязычных избирателей, потому что, например, в этом году это же не одни выборы, а четыре раза будут выборы. $600 на каждом участке. На что Марк Трегер сказал, что даже эта общая сумма, когда умножишь на все эти районы и на все эти участки, выливается в очень небольшую сумму в 80-миллиардном бюджете города Нью-Йорк. И речь идет об очень скромных суммах, которые бы навсегда решили эту проблему.
Final question I have, and this is it. Are you aware of any protocol, whether verbal or writing, of BOE employees, poll workers, or coordinators being told to call the police or reprimand people that speak Russian in poll sites? And coupled with, what is the protocol from the Board of Elections to report any form of voter intimidations at the poll site?
Какие правила существуют сегодня у городской избирательной комиссии? Как инструктируют будущих работников участков по поводу русского языка? Существует ли у вас пример? Знаете ли вы о том, как иногда преследуют работников, которые начинают говорить на русском языке с избирателями, которые не понимают по-английски?
I'm not personally aware of such matters as the councilman has set forth. However, we do get some of our information anecdotally, such as the type of a situation that you alluded to earlier in your opening remarks. There are various ways that information can come to the Board of Elections. We have a hotline that's set up, a voter hotline on election day. We have assembly district monitoring teams that go out and respond to issues. We also get reports back from the poll site coordinators about specific instances. I myself, on election day, go out from very early in the morning and we go to areas to deal with problems. Sometimes that's been in the borough of Brooklyn. Other times we had a special election up in the Bronx, and sometimes people don't always understand fully their responsibilities, and we work to adjust that on election day. But when you're talking about a workforce of, you know, over 30,000, upwards of 36,000 poll workers on election day, you know, it's understandable that there might be some instances of this, but not understandable, but not tolerable. I mean, and those two things are different.
Только что Майкл Райан сказал, что ему неизвестно о таких случаях преследования русскоязычных работников за то, что они общаются на русском языке с непонимающими по-английски избирателями, но в то же самое время он говорит, что иногда о таких примерах он слышал, ему кто-то говорил, но официально у него такой информации не поступало. Он напомнил, что есть горячая линия в день выборов городской избирательной комиссии, можно всегда звонить и жаловаться на какие-то притеснения на участках, на любые случаи, как оно по-английски называется, intimidation. Он сказал, что в городе Нью-Йорке в день выборов обычно 36 тысяч человек работают на избирательных участках, и он не может гарантировать, что кто-то не нарушил какие-то законы и как-то не притеснял избирателя. Он просит об этом обязательно уведомлять городскую избирательную комиссию. Также он сказал, что в каждом ассамблейном округе есть так называемые AD monitors, люди, которые ездят от городской избирательной комиссии, проверяют, что происходит на том или ином участке. Если вы их видите, можете пожаловаться, сказать, что вам не разрешают говорить на русском языке, и вы не понимаете, что происходит. Это будет очень серьезно оцениваться, рассматриваться, наказываться и так далее.
I would just close by saying, Director Ryan, I'd like for us to follow up on this conversation. The issue, though, that you raised before about websites and hotlines and monitors, most of these seniors probably, I could safely assume, are not, you know, very, they don't frequent websites too much. Secondly, many AD monitors themselves do not speak Russian. And third, I'm not sure if even the hotline to call for problems are answered by anyone that speaks Russian.
Right.
So the issue is that many of their problems and issues, there's no way to get them to you. There's no official protocol way to get them to you. What I shared with you on the record before was something that I witnessed.
Absolutely, and I understand that.
And I, quite frankly, I never want to see anything like that happen again. So we need to, this is a starting point. This is not the final point of this conversation. We'll be working with our city and state partners on making sure that these residents received equal justice under the law.
Right, and I just would like to close as well with, I'm cognizant that every 2 weeks the city of New York is kind enough to deposit money into my checking account for the services that I provide for the preceding 2 weeks. It is my duty as someone who has a position that is funded by the taxpayers to make sure that we do everything that we can and to make myself available, even if the hours are not always so convenient. So I have gone at evening hours. Some of your other colleagues have asked me to go to community events and come talk to folks. If you want to do it during the day at your local office where we can bring people in and continue the conversation, because we have over 1,200 poll sites throughout the city on an election day. It's impossible for me to know all of the problems at every poll site. But if I never hear of them, we can never fix them. And even if we start the conversation to fix those things that we can within the law as it presently exists, that conversation will lead us to where the law may need to be fixed.
Let me translate. At least I will translate briefly. Депутат Горсовета Марк Трегер в заключение своей речи, выступления, вопросов городской избирательной комиссии сказал, что, опять же, его не устроили ответы городской избирательной комиссии. Например, он сказал, что не так уж много русскоязычных пожилых людей активно ходят на веб-сайты городской избирательной комиссии. Никто никогда не дозвонился на эту горячую линию, и там по-русски все равно никто не говорит, поэтому пожилому русскоязычному избирателю туда звонить бесполезно. И что все случаи, о которых сегодня говорят, это не анекдот, это не вымысел, это правдивые реальные истории из жизни. И он хочет, чтобы городская избирательная комиссия извлекла из этого уроки, и чтобы людей, которые ездят в день выборов по участкам, чтобы среди них было гораздо больше русскоязычных иммигрантов, что тоже поможет упростить эту ситуацию. В ответ горосбирком Майкл Райан сказал, что он получает зарплату от налогоплательщиков Нью-Йорка. Каждые две недели ему депозируют чек, он сказал, на его банковский счет. И он считает, что это его прямой долг и обязанность выполнять законы города Нью-Йорка, прислушиваться к мнению законодателей города, избирателей, налогоплательщиков. И он говорит, я езжу на очень многие общинные события, выступаю на русскоязычном радио, готов ездить в день выборов на любые участки. У нас 1200 участков в городе Нью-Йорке в день выборов. И он сказал, что он готов, открыт, приезжать на встречу с любыми организациями, отвечать на любые вопросы, даже в вечернее время.
I just want to thank Councilmember Traeger for fighting for this issue since we've been in office. So that's 2 years, 1 month, and 29 days that he's been focused on this issue. So I think just to take you up on the offer, what we're asking for at this point, along with passage of this resolution, is an all-hands meeting in Brooklyn with the clerk, the deputy clerk, the commissioners for Brooklyn, Democrat and Republican, you, whoever you deem integral, as well as because of the political nature of your entity, the district leaders from both parties should also be invited, and this would be an evening meeting, with and also including the trainer, training oversight and training staff.
Только что председатель комитета по управлению правительством, по контролю за деятельностью правительства, господин Келлос предложил, сказал, что он надеется, что после сегодняшних слушаний городская избирательная комиссия организует встречу с, в первую очередь, с русскоязычными избирателями, не только с русскоязычными в Бруклине, с участием всех депутатов горсовета тех или иных районов, о которых идет речь, лидеров республиканцев и демократов тех или иных округов ассамблеи, о которых идет речь, где бы именно этот вопрос обсуждался бы предметно, что можно сделать, чтобы не было больше никаких случаев давления на избирателей, чтобы они не уходили разочарованными с избирательных участков. И он похвалил депутата Трегера, который, по его словам, 2 года и 2 месяца и уже вот сколько часов сегодня, с первого дня занимается этой проблемой, чтобы упростить голосование для пожилых русскоязычных иммигрантов.
Да.
Well, there's a long list of folks. I don't control all of them. I can certainly commit to the people that are under my auspices.
And
I can commit to their attendance.
And make sure that they're invited and just let
yes.
my office and Mark Traeger's office know if anyone declines the invitation or does not RSVP.
And under those circumstances, I think, you know, the council members of the individual districts may have a better handle on to whom the local political invitations need to be made better than the Board of Elections. But we can certainly check our records as well.
Thank you very much for coming in ahead of the presidential primary and Super Tuesday.
And like prior to the certification of the special election in the Bronx.
Thank you. So we'll excuse this panel. And our next panelist is going to be Assembly Member Pamela Harris. Congratulations. And if you could please.
Депутат Ассамблеи Памела Харрис сейчас будет выступать. Депутат Ассамблеи штата Памела Харрис, 46-й избирательный округ Бруклина.
Thank you. Good afternoon to you all. Good afternoon. Thank you. You know, I wanted to start out a certain way, but I'm going to just revert back a little bit to a statement that was said in reference to getting paid for this type of work that, although I don't take anything away from anyone, but there are so many individuals that are actually sitting here. I was in the overflow room, and you have Sophia Lobaba, you have Anna, you have a reporter here, you have people who take pictures that volunteer constantly to interpret, to do photography, to work at the polls, and don't receive a dime.
Памела Харрис хочет отметить, что сегодня очень много речь говорили о том, кому и сколько платят, и в том числе руководитель городской избирательной комиссии напомнил, что он получает зарплату. Но она хочет подчеркнуть, что огромное количество людей в день выборов, кроме тех, кто работает на избирательных участках и получает какие-то деньги, огромное количество людей волонтерами работают, помогают избирателям. Например, она назвала Софию Лобову, известную вам, бывшего президента Хейберхаус Синьор Центра, назвала журналистов, назвала людей, которые добровольно стараются помогать русскоязычным избирателям, имеющим проблемы в день выборов.
So it just bothered me a little bit to hear that we had to hear that someone is okay with receiving their paycheck every 2 weeks, and they will continue to do their work when none of you receive a dime for doing the hard work that you do.
Памела Харрис просто немножко возмутилась тем, что руководитель горизбиркома сказал, что вот я получаю зарплату, и поэтому буду за эту зарплату работать, а многие из вас помогают русскоязычным избирателям на протяжении очень многих лет абсолютно бесплатно, считают это своим долгом.
So as a member of the assembly, I am going to work extremely hard to make sure that all of my colleagues understand what is important here and what we need to reach. We need to make sure that many people here in our Brooklyn neighborhoods, all of you have fought so hard to obtain your citizenship status. We need to make sure that this, we work hard to make sure that you understand what your status is, and that's the right to vote.
Мы хотим, чтобы вы знали, что нас эта проблема очень волнует. Мы должны сделать все возможное, чтобы ваше право голосовать, право понимать, что происходит. Для нас это очень-очень важно, является для нас приоритетом.
That's why I'm proud to stand with my colleagues, Assemblymember Bill Colton, Councilmember Mark Traeger, in support for providing Russian interpreters in polling locations. This bill will go a long way in bringing fairness and will increase participation in government, giving many mothers, brothers, and neighbors a voice.
Я хочу, чтобы вы знали, что я вместе с депутатом Ассамблеи штата Нью-Йорк Биллом Колтоном работаю в Олбани и с депутатом Горсовета Марком Трейгером здесь, в городе Нью-Йорке, для того, чтобы наши матери, дедушки, бабушки, братья, сестры все имели возможность в день выборов выполнить свой гражданский долг, не испытывая при этом никаких препятствий, не имея никаких проблем.
You deserve to be respected and the opportunity to be heard on issues that matter to you and our community.
Вы имеете полное право в день выборов приходить на избирательный участок, имеете полное право заслуживать уважения за то, что вы делаете для нашей общины, и вы имеете полное право в день выборов пользоваться всеми правами избирателей Америки.
As we have seen, especially many of us in the neighborhood of Coney Island and Brighton Beach, that there is represented tremendously by Russian immigrants who have settled here for many years.
Районы Брайтон-Бич и Кони-Айленд имеют особенно большое количество русскоязычных иммигрантов, которые изменили облик этих районов и внесли огромный вклад на протяжении уже десятилетий в процветание этих районов.
These are individuals who care for their communities. I remember the other, a few weeks ago at an event when I hear Anna sounding like an angel singing "God Bless America."
Всегда для меня очень трогательно, когда я слышу выступление, например, Анны Малкиной, когда она исполняет песню "God Bless America", или когда я слышу вижу патриотизм, американский патриотизм русскоязычных иммигрантов, это очень трогательно, мило, и это показывает, с каким желанием русскоязычные иммигранты хотят голосовать, участвовать в жизни Соединенных Штатов Америки.
The first line, "God bless America, the land that I love." It's not just a land that everyone else loves. It's the land that you all love.
И мне очень приятно, что вот именно вы говорите, Боже, храни Америку, что вы любите Америку. Это очень-очень мне приятно видеть и слышать.
And it's a land that you guys, you all have worked hard for. And you deserve the right. You deserve this. This, I don't even understand why we're actually sitting here. I don't understand why we're sitting here asking for the right for someone to help us understand a right that you earned as a citizen.
Я вообще не понимаю, почему мы сегодня должны здесь собираться, обсуждать эту проблему, которая, на мой взгляд, очень простая, о том, чтобы люди, граждане США, которые любят Америку, у которых есть какие-то проблемы с английским языком, могли исполнить свой гражданский долг, и мы еще должны кому-то что-то доказывать, объяснять. Я вообще ничего этого не понимаю.
It is no surprise that a community like Brighton Beach is called Little Odessa. It's built and influenced by outstanding residents. Who have called this home for many years.
И не случайно Брайтон Бич часто называют маленькой Одессой. Все знают, что в частности в районе Брайтон Бич живут тысячи и тысячи русскоязычных иммигрантов, которые любят этот район, этот город и эту страну.
These residents have opened shops, restaurants, offices and schools, among other things. They have contributed to our economy and bringing in jobs.
Русскоязычные иммигранты открывают бизнесы, медицинские офисы, адвокатские офисы, школы, самые разнообразные бизнесы, являются профессионалами в разных отраслях, создают рабочие места, вкладывают огромные силы, усилия, приносят большие блага для экономики города Нью-Йорка.
As your assemblywoman, I will work hard to make sure that our community isn't left out.
И как ваш ассамблевумен, как ваш депутат ассамблеи, я буду очень напряженно работать, чтобы ваши права были защищены. И чтобы у вас были необходимые лингвистические, языковые ресурсы в день выборов.
That is why it is my duty as your representative to fight for the right to be involved and informed. While continuously making our state a great place to live and raise our families, as you have all done.
Это моя обязанность депутата ассамблеи сделать все возможное, чтобы вы в этом штате, в штате Нью-Йорк, чувствовали себя абсолютно комфортно и все ваши права соблюдались.
Thank you all very much, and God bless America. Спасибо.
Russian is improving.
Thank you, Assemblymember Harris, for joining us, sitting through quite the beginnings of what is it going to be a long hearing today. Councilmember Traeger has to vote for land use. We have four hearings that all of us have to be at the same time.
And I'm on my way to Albany right now.
Депутат Горсовета Марк Трейгер вышел, потому что ему срочно нужно было в здание Сити-Холла сейчас голосовать по очень важному законопроекту, связанному с строительством доступного жилья, поэтому он срочно вышел, он обязательно вернется. А Памеле Харрис сейчас нужно ехать в Олбани, она работает депутатом ассамблеи, там тоже заседание в Олбани. Сейчас она специально приехала, чтобы выступить перед вами, высказать свою точку зрения.
Oh, thank you. From and Assembly Member, I guess my quick question is, what can we? I'm sorry that we can't take questions, but again, please write them, give them to Council Member.
Все вопросы только в письменном виде, пожалуйста, еще раз просят, иначе тут будут удалять.
What can we do here in New York City to support you in Albany in getting these important laws passed?
Что должны мы здесь сделать сегодня в Горсовете, чтобы помочь, чтобы в Олбани такой закон был принят и больше не было отговорок?
Well, you started. This is the way. This is the opening of the door right here. The rezo has to be. We have to make sure that everyone votes yes, that this is an important issue. I think the next step too is you, as mentioned by Councilman Traeger, is to meet again. This was just the first of should be of many. But I think we all need to go to Albany together. Yeah. I think we need to go. Let's go. Let's talk with make sure that everyone understands the importance.
Памела Харрис сказала, что сегодня этот процесс пошел, что называется, но очень важно, чтобы, во-первых, проголосовали за эту резолюцию, желательно единогласно, депутаты Горсовета. И второй этап, она просит депутатов Горсовета, которые поддерживают эту резолюцию, поехать вместе с ней в Олбани, там лоббировать принятие этого закона, чтобы поехали не только депутаты Ассамблеи, как им положено, но и поехали депутаты Горсовета и активисты общины тоже. Нужен еще один закон, сегодня об этом говорили.
Is there any question that I haven't had a chance to ask that I should be asking?
No, I'm good. Let's just fight together on this. I think it's heartfelt, of course, for me, but some things are no-brainers. These are just simple quests. It's a quest, and it's a simple quest, and it should be fulfilled.
Thank you very much for your testimony today.
Thank you.
Our next panel, we're going to do, and again, as mentioned earlier, we're going to have a panel of those of you from the audience who came out today. So that's going to include Vladimir R. and Vladimir Fortuny from 1199 SEIU. And Vladimir Fortuny will go first. Then we have Sophia Lobova.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Sophia Lobova, yes.
And then Fira. And then rounding out, we'll be asking Ari Kagan to testify in his role as a district leader after he finishes translating for the panel. If everyone who I called up, please come up.
Сейчас выступят четыре человека. Первым будет выступать Владимир Фортунный, вице-президент профсоюза 1199, работников здравоохранения. Второй будет выступать София Лобова. Она зарегистрировалась для участия в этих слушаниях. Третья будет выступать Фира Стукельман. На четвертом буду выступать я, после чего слушания будут закругляться.
I should see four people sitting at that table.
Пожалуйста, подойдите, сядьте возле Владимира Фортунного, Фира и София, пожалуйста. Владимир Фортуна. Еще записался Владимир Рипа. Будете выступать? Нет.
No. Thanks.
In the interest of time, we're going to limit you to just 2 minutes, and then we'll follow up with questions.
У вас есть по 2 минуты выступить и ответить на вопросы.
Okay, very good.
And feel free to speak in whichever language you feel comfortable.
Вы можете говорить на любом языке.
Я тогда буду выступать на русском языке. Здравствуйте. Меня зовут Владимир Фортунный. Я вице-президент профсоюза 1199. И приглашение Марка Трейгера прийти и тестифайть на этих слушаниях для меня это было просто очень большая необходимость, я скажу, и возможность высказать точку зрения людей, с которыми я работаю и которых я представляю.
My name is Vladimir Fortuna. I'm a vice president of 1199 Union of Healthcare Workers. When Councilman Mark Traeger invited me to these public hearings, I was very happy and I said that it's a necessity, especially because I represent thousands of healthcare workers, home care workers, and it's a very important issue for them.
За последние 18 лет работы с профсоюзом 1199, с работниками по уходу на дому, я очень близко на ежедневной основе имею дело с русской общиной, вот, с хомотендами, которые также представляют клиентам, в основном пожилых людей, выходцев из бывшего Советского Союза. И каждый год, когда происходят выборы, мы имеем проблему, скажем так, проблему посещения нашими русскоязычными людьми избирательных участков.
Перевести, дайте перевести. For more than 18 years I work with Russian-speaking home care workers, and at every election day we have these complaints and issues and problems all the time because they serve elderly population, seniors and disabled, and very often they're calling to us, complaining about what they really see on poll sites every election time.
Intimidation или, как сказать, интимидация наших, особенно пожилых людей, которые не говорят на английском языке, когда они приходят на выборные участки, вот, в той или иной мере влияет на то, что люди, получив негативный экспириенс первый раз, просто отказываются больше идти на выборные участки.
Many Russian-speaking seniors, first time where they feel, they see intimidation, they see they're not welcomed at poll sites. After this bad experience, very often they're not coming back second or third time, and we are losing voters because they do not believe in American democracy anymore.
Очень много людей, с которыми я имею дело, когда заходит разговор насчет выборов, они говорят, я не пойду, потому что, и любые причины, которые говорят, они все сводятся к тому, что они боятся, что они не получат, не только не получат помощи на избирательном участке, а также, что и к ним, их, им просто будут пренебрегать.
Many Russian seniors, many Russian-speaking seniors feel not just that they will not get necessary assistance at polling sites, but they will be completely ignored. And like intimidated, and some of them fear this and decided not to vote anymore.
Не у всех есть возможность, не у всех есть привилегия иметь home attendant, которая сможет немножко говорить по-английски, которая сможет помочь в выборах и, то есть проголосовать и или объяснить сам процесс голосования. И из-за этого многие работники по уходу на дому, которые ухаживают за клиентами, также не идут голосовать, потому что они не могут оставить клиента.
And today was mentioned that Russian-speaking seniors can bring their home care workers with them to translate, to help. But many of these home care workers are not happy with this assignment to help with translation on the poll site. They also feel intimidated. And after learning from this experience, not just Russian-speaking seniors do not want to come back to vote, but also home care workers started to fear this experience.
So I will say that the amendment of this election law, I think, is very important, and it will change the politics in the boroughs where the people live. And I think the Mark Traeger started something which is must be enforced, especially because the laws exist. Thank you.
И только что Владимир Фортуна приветствовал усилия депутата Марка Трегера и его коллег по горсовету. Он считает, что законов уже достаточно, и что даже в рамках существующих законов можно добиться радикального изменения ситуации на избирательных участках.
Next speaker, please.
Okay. Thank you.
Please stay on the panel to answer questions from Councilmember Traeger.
Yes.
So please press the red button and give your testimony.
София Лобова. Нужно нажать красную кнопочку, чтобы там горело. Там красная гореть должна.
Да, горит.
София Лобова is a former president of Haber House Senior Center, which is one of the largest poll sites in the Russian-speaking community in Brooklyn.
Thank you very much for today, for this meeting. It's very important. I will transfer in Russia, okay?
Okay. Will help.
Много лет тому был старт к вопросу о том, что нам необходим русский язык на избирательных участках.
We're talking about this issue for many, many, many years.
А начинал это Ари Каган. Он бомбил на радио, на выступлениях, на встречах с нами.
Ари Каган was one of the first people who was involved in this issue many years ago.
Трейгер, наш депутат, вот уже два года об этом говорит.
Now Councilman Mark Traeger is talking about it for more than 2 years.
Научиться говорить полностью на русском языке, но он все понимает. И я не буду долго вас задерживать, хочу сказать только,
что
все, что сегодня было сказано Марком Трейгеном и предъявлено избирательной комиссии, это все правда.
I agree with every single word that Councilman Mark Traeger said today, especially when he talked to a representative from Board of Elections.
Это необходимо, но что мы услышали? Совершенно не удовлетворены ответами председателя избирательной комиссии.
I'm very unhappy about answers from the Board of Elections. I'm very unhappy about his explanations and excuses. And it's obviously We don't see any cooperation from the Board of Election.
И вот занимаясь много лет выборами и будучи координатором на участках, ведь участки не одинаковые все, и избирательная комиссия обязана знать статистику, где сколько голосующих русскоязычных. Некоторых, на
Board of Elections must know where the most of the Russian-speaking voters are actually participating in elections, and they pretend they don't know.
На некоторых участках за весь день проголосует 30 человек до 50, а на некоторых 300 человек.
At some polling sites, 30 people voting, and another 500 people voting, and they know exactly who these people are.
А инспекторов, обслуживающего персонала в этот день на этом участке, одинаковое количество. Там, где 50 человек, 35, может быть 12 человек, 14 человек.
Meanwhile, Sofia pointed to another problem. Sometimes at the poll sites with usually 30-40 people votes, there are 12 poll workers. And the polling site where 500-600 people votes, 6 poll workers. And why such a discrepancy?
Там, где и такое же количество, там, где 300 человек. В Хейберхаусе, Нью-Йорк-центре, голосует русскоязычная в основном публика. Это 85%.
About 85% of people voting at Хейберхаус Senior Center at Coney Island are Russian-speaking seniors.
И такое же количество инспекторов. И не разрешаю, я удивлена председателю комиссии, ведь его сотрудники приходят на выборы, на проверку выборов, и возмущены, почему наши инспектора говорят на русском языке.
I was shocked to hear the explanation from the Board of Elections today when he said that AD monitors are helping constituents to vote. Completely opposite. Usually AD monitors are coming from Board of Elections and they're criticizing and sometimes punishing poll workers who dare to speak in Russian with Russian-speaking seniors.
И я думаю, что главная задача избирательных комиссий сегодня, собирая на тренинги своих инспекторов, обслуживающий персонал, высказать все предложения, которые мы слышали здесь, о том, чтобы человек, председатель сказал, что он не возражает, чтобы говорили на русском языке.
It's critical that the Board of Elections during training seminars and sessions publicly said that it's not prohibited to speak Russian when we're talking about Russian-speaking senior voters and Russian-speaking poll workers. That it's not prohibited for them to communicate in Russian if it's important, and there is no translation, other translation provided.
Yeah. Thank you.
That this behavior is not illegal.
Please stay for questions.
Останьтесь, пожалуйста, вам будут вопросы еще задавать.
Okay.
My name is Vera Stukelman. I'm a Holocaust survivor, and I would like to say it's my pain, no people. Everybody busy, only us not busy. We came here to, my heart is broken. Why? We were abused by Nazis. We were abused by Stalin. We were abused by communists. I was persecuted 10 years. I couldn't get visa to go to America. We came to the best country, democracy country in the world. Why we came to this country? Freedom for speech, freedom for religious, freedom from press. And what we have? What we have? Abusing again? When we came to what? All this beginning for myself in 2001. We had Assemblywoman Adele Cohen. This was a monster. This wasn't Assemblywoman like today sit here. She always invade police. She always do damage to us. She punishment us.
Fira,
we didn't understand what's going on.
Fira, let me translate.
Пожалуйста, переводи.
Okay. Фира Стугельман сказала, что она пережила Холокост, о том, что ее притесняли нацисты, ее притеснял сталинист, Сталин. сталинский режим, коммунистический режим, и что большинство русскоязычных иммигрантов приехали сюда со статусом беженца в поисках лучшей жизни, за демократией, свободой слова, свободой религии, свободой волеизъявления. И с чем же мы сталкиваемся на избирательных участках? Мы опять сталкиваемся с притеснениями, дискриминацией. Фира говорит, что она сама подвергалась такой дискриминации, и в частности говорит о бывшем депутате Ассамблеи штата Нью-Йорк, который зовут Адель Коэн, которая по каждому поводу, если слышала русский язык на избирательном участке, особенно в Шурфронте, сразу вызывала полицию, и что она сказала, никакого сравнения нет с нынешним депутатом Ассамблеи Памелой Харрис, которую она очень уважает.
And when we begin working with our people to teach them how to work in the poll, nobody from board election didn't do any seminar. Nobody learned us how to working. Nobody. We do by ourselves. In people, some woman, she with flies go inside. She would like, I'm sorry, to the ladies' room. Adele Cohen and her people invite police. She do wrong. This is not, she cannot do this. And not only this, in September 9, 2009, it was adopted special law about Russian literatures, about Russian language.
State law. You
know. In what our government do it?
Wrap up.
Okay. Фира, заканчивайте.
Listen, I will finish. This is my pain. Believe me.
She's
I prepare
about
myself. This is my pain and their pain too. Okay. Они меня заставляют закончить. А я говорю, это моя боль. И я не хочу. Я хочу высказаться.
Окей. Окей.
And не надо было? Надо было. Не надо было.
Окей. You know what? Wrap it up, Фика. Фира.
The governor ignore us. My opinion, we have to do a meeting together with governor. He never came to our community. He don't want to know who is Russian community.
So I have a couple of questions, just very quickly. Vice President Fortuny, I really appreciate you being here today. I know you shared with me a story about your mom's difficulty with the election process. I'm just curious, because you sat listening to the Board of Elections. I asked them a question about what is their protocol when voters have problems or feel intimidation because of their language. And we didn't really get much answers from the Board of Elections here today. I was wondering if you could just elaborate and share, did your mom, you know, what was her experience like, and was she notified what protocols to follow to report voter intimidation or just a lack of assistance in general?
Депутат Трегер только что спросил у Владимира Фортунного, чтобы он привел какой-то пример, когда он знает о случаях intimidation, о случаях, когда с людьми не хотели разговаривать на избирательных участках, притесняли, если они начинали, что бы то ни было, спрашивать по-русски. В частности, мама Владимира Фортунного имела такой экспириенс.
Well, I had that experience with my mother for quite a few times, and sometimes it was neutral. But half of the time, it was pretty much aggressively negative. You know, when my mother came to vote, and I was beside her, telling her how to do procedure, sign in, you know, what ED, what booth to go, and stuff like that. And not only that little process, which it takes like, what, 5-10 minutes, you know, with one individual like my mother, you know, I'm feeling confident. But there is always a group of people who usually older people who standing there, like, and they come to you like, excuse me, can you tell us, can you help us? And you can see this need into translation, into interpretation of what have to be done on that voting side, basics. Which is actually basics, yes, which is not exist.
Только что Владимир Фортуна сказал, что это не только его матери касается, но и других пожилых людей, которых он видел русскоязычных на избирательных участках, которые, когда его видели и понимали, что он по-английски говорит и пришел с мамой, сразу бросались к нему за помощью. А где нам идти голосовать? А где наш стол? А где наша машина избирательная? А куда нам обратиться? Даже простые вопросы. И это тоже вызывало и возражения некоторых работников. Им говорили, вы потише, вы не должны это по-русски говорить, вы не должны это спрашивать.
And your mom is fortunate to have, you know, you there with her. I imagine you share my anger and frustration hearing from the Board of Elections that the onus is on them.
Exactly.
To bring people down to help direct traffic, when in reality, the onus is on the government to make sure that there is equal access and equal justice under the law for all citizens of this country and of this city.
Exactly. And as I said before, that relatives who's representing relatives is not always can be there. And me, as a being a representative for many, many years of the a huge amount of Russian-speaking, over 10,000 Russian-speaking home attendants working and represented by my union in Brooklyn alone, and I will say 40% more or less does not speak enough English to feel comfortable, you know, on the voting poll. And that is a lost vote because people simply do not vote. They afraid to go because they do not have translation representation and so forth.
Многие пожилые люди, многие home attendants не хотят идти голосовать во многом именно из-за этой проблемы, из-за проблем с переводом, с недостаточным английским языком. Они не хотят подвергаться каким бы то ни было унижениям. И некоторые бывают один раз пришли, и после этого уже никогда не приходят.
And quite frankly, I am disgusted when I hear government leaders lecture the population about we have low voter participation, but yet are responsible for the barriers to increase voter participation. And we heard today that you have elected officials here, and I will help lead the charge working with my colleagues from the city and the state who are willing to put in resources. We're talking about peanuts. We're talking about not every poll site in New York City, but certain areas that have large Russian-speaking population. We're ready to put in the resources to hire Russian-speaking interpreters. So we are about breaking down barriers. But I want everyone to know that those politicians that will stand in our way to break down those barriers, we will make them as part of the public record as well.
Депутат Горсовета Марк Трейгер сказал, что мы сделаем все возможное, чтобы все знали, какие политики сопротивляются введению русскоязычных переводчиков на избирательных участках и переводу материалов по выборам на русский язык. Мы сделаем все возможное, чтобы вы точно знали, кто выступает против этой меры.
And that we will, if it's a matter of resources, we will find in a budget of over $80 billion, we'll find the money to get the resources.
В городском бюджете размером 80 миллиардов долларов, безусловно, есть деньги для того, чтобы нанять очень небольшое количество русскоязычных переводчиков на тех участках, где много пожилых русскоязычных избирателей голосуют.
And I thank you, all of you, for being here today. Thank you, Sofa. Thank you, Fira. And thank you, Mr. Fortuny, as well.
I will be very brief.
Our last panelist,
today,
Ari Kagan, who will give his testimony and then translate for himself.
Yes, it will be very brief, I promise. So, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I wanted to thank Councilman Kallos. Of course, I wanted to thank Councilman Mark Traeger, all colleagues who are supporting this resolution. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Ari Kagan, and I'm a Democratic District Leader in 45th Assembly District in Brooklyn. I wrote my own testimony, so nobody wrote it for me. For many years, I was actively involved in the political process. I ran for New York State Assembly, for District Leader, and for New York City Council. That is why I know the issue of Russian-speaking translators and Russian language election materials. I know it perfectly well. It is a very unfortunate situation and a clear example of discrimination and disenfranchisement of the Russian-speaking immigrant community. We are not talking about young professionals. We are not talking about American-born second-generation Russian immigrants. We are talking about tens of thousands Russian-speaking seniors who are not fluent in English. Every election, I see elderly immigrants from our community having extreme difficulty at polling sites due to their inability to communicate in English. Every year, Board of Elections assigns Spanish, Chinese, and Korean translators at poll sites on Coney Island, Brighton Beach, Manhattan Beach, Shepstead Bay, Midwood, Bensonhurst, Forest Hills, Rigo Park, Kew Gardens, Pelham Parkway, Co-op City, Riverdale, Washington Heights, South Beach. And in all of these places, there are thousands and thousands of Russian-speaking seniors who have real difficulties communicating with poll workers in English. Current Board of Elections regulations prohibit Russian-speaking poll workers to speak in their native language with voters unless there are two Russian-speaking workers representing both Democrats and Republicans who should be present during these conversations, which is very impractical. In many cases, Russian-speaking seniors are unable to find their table, proper voting machines, or to understand voting instructions, especially when there are numerous elections at the same time. It is beyond my understanding why Russian-speaking translators are not allowed at Brighton Beach or Forest Hills, while Korean Mandarin translators are always present there. So I strongly support the resolution proposed by Councilman Mark Traeger and co-sponsored by many of his colleagues. I urge all members of New York City Council who represent diverse immigrant communities in the capital of the world to send a clear message to Albany. It is long overdue to pass the state legislation and to make sure smooth voting process for all Russian-speaking New Yorkers. Please do the right thing and support the proposed resolution 398. Our community would be forever grateful for your efforts to correct the long-time injustice and to stop this disenfranchisement of the Russian-speaking voters. Thank you very much. I will briefly translate. Я сказал, что это дискриминация. Я сказал, что это 100% дискриминация, 100% унижение русскоязычных избирателей, когда на тех участках, где тысячи голосуют русскоязычных пожилых людей, сидят переводчики с корейского языка, с китайского языка, с бенгальского языка, и нет русскоязычных переводчиков в тех районах, которые, скажем, Брайтон-Бич, или Форест-Хиллс, или Бенсонхерст, в тех районах, где много русскоязычных избирателей. Я считаю, что это абсолютно неприемлемо, и поблагодарил Марка Трейгера и Бена Келлоса, их коллег, призвал их проголосовать единогласно за эту резолюцию.
One.
Do you have any questions?
I just want to say, just a quick comment, Ari. Ari, it is correct, and let the record show, that you have been one of the first people for well over a decade, maybe two decades now, speaking up for the rights of all people. Because this is not just about the Russian-speaking community. This is about all of our people in our communities. I don't believe there's one person in this room that is against translation for people that speak Bengali or people that speak Korean or Chinese or Spanish. We welcome this. But at the same time, the government has to welcome the Russian-speaking community as well. And the numbers bear that out. And so, Ari, I thank you for your leadership for many years, wearing many different hats along the way. I thank you, Fira. As pointed out, many of the people in this room are Holocaust survivors, World War II veterans. Quite frankly, if it was not for the coalition with the Americans and you, I'm not sure if this world would be free today. So we are indebted to you to make this happen. And if it's a matter of money, we should break down the barrier and make it happen. But we will go to every office in this government to get support to make this a reality. So thank you very much, Ari, for your leadership.
I just wanted to say that I skipped two lines about Bangladeshi community. I wrote here that I was glad to learn that New York City Bangladeshi community achieved a major victory convincing city and state elected officials to translate all voting materials into Bengali. So I'm proud of them and I'm very happy for them. But I also want to, like you mentioned, equal protection under the law. I want same benefits and same opportunities and same translation for the Russian speaking, especially seniors. Who are not fluent in English, as you noticed today with all of these translations.
And we have a last question to the vice president election. It will be good, the seminar, together with us, and we would like to talk.
We will follow up on making that meeting a reality, too. Thank you.
Thank
you, Fira.
So I just want to thank everyone for coming out today. We will have a meeting in Brooklyn with the Brooklyn Board of Elections. And please send your questions to Councilmember Traeger. I will join him in a letter to Board of Elections.
Мы обязательно
sure
будем иметь встречу в Бруклине с советом по выборам, с депутатом Марком Трейгером. И Бен Келло сказал, что обязательно приедет сам в Бруклин и сделает встречу, чтобы было руководство совета по выборам, где можно будет детально задать все вопросы, обсудить все проблемы и потребовать как можно более быстрых решений.
And я думаю, что все Надо сказать thank you and спасибо to Chair Ben Kallos for
Absolutely.
Having this committee here today. Пожалуйста.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Огромное
please,
спасибо.
Please make sure to say so to my in-laws. We're going to recess for 5 minutes and thank the Campaign Finance Board, which is up next.
Maybe don't have the full time to do it. Yeah. Of the polls, should the poll
worker,
yeah.
Can tell them how to do the job.
Mm-hmm.
If someone comes in with somebody who's assisting them,
right.
They don't hear very well, they don't see very well. The poll worker is supposed to give that person an oath that says, I'm here to assist,
I see.
This is who I am. This is my relationship to the voter, and I promise that I'm not going to influence their vote. There's no reason for anything horrible like that to happen.
Yeah.
The question of you can't speak the language of the person. I mean, obviously, there's got to be some English happening.
Yeah.
Because the oath is in English, and there's got to be some understanding
right.
of that. But there should never have come up with this thing. You can't
Where it's
speak
someone
Russian.
Calling the
you can't
yeah.
speak Russian.
Because if they give the oath and they take it, then
right,
it should,
right,
be,
right, right, right.
should be fine. Yeah.
Oh, you
sure.
need her.
Yes.
Of course.
Okay, go ahead. You can talk more.
Yeah.
now call this meeting back to order. Just want to thank everyone for their patience and for our first GovOps hearing that was bilingual in English and Russian. We will no longer be engaging in the Russian translation services as the 50 or so folks who were here from the Russian-speaking community have left now that their agenda item has moved on. Anyone here or who is watching at home who does require language translation services, please contact my committee, and you can email me, bkalos@benkalos, to request translation services, and we're happy to do so. Do also want to apologize. We had hoped for simultaneous translation services. However, apparently the issue is just we were using a lot of technical terms, such as resolution and legislation and Board of Elections and items where typically that's going to be required a different level of translation skill. And so we are grateful for members of the community having stepped up and for having gotten through it. Our goal is to have professional translation staff where possible. And so just as we go, we will have 10 minutes of testimony from the Campaign Finance Board, followed by a panel of good government groups and advocates. And thank you very much again to everyone for their patience. And I'd like to now ask Amy Lopress and her panel to please go. And I will actually ask you to hold your right hand up. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and respond honestly to council member questions?
I do.
And will you give your testimony in Russian?
I won't. Unfortunately. Good afternoon, Chair Kallos. I'm Amy Lopress, Executive Director of the New York City Campaign Finance Board. With me today is Eric Friedman, Assistant Executive Director for Public Affairs, and Sue Oyland Odell, our General Counsel. Thank you for the opportunity to testify on the bills under consideration today. Now that we've entered into this pivotal presidential election year, we are happy to see a renewed focus around the urgency, around the movement to help more New Yorkers make their voices heard in the electoral process. As you know, the Campaign Finance Board works to promote civic involvement through our voter engagement campaign, NYC Votes. We register New Yorkers to vote and provide them information about where and how to use how to cast their ballots. We also provide voters with a wide range of resources to help inform their choices at the poll. The centerpiece of our voter information efforts is the city's official voter guide for municipal elections, mandated by the New York City Charter. The guide provides an opportunity to all candidates for city office to transmit their message to registered voters free of charge. We mail a print guide to every household with a registered voter before every primary and general election for mayor, public advocate, controller, borough president, and city council, and when there is a city referendum on the ballot. The charter requires a guide to contain biographical information on each candidate, as well as statement by each candidate of his or her principles, platforms, or views. We produce a video edition. We publish an edition of the voter guide online on our website, www.nyccfb.info, which we also publish for state, federal, and special elections. For non-city offices, our online guide includes links out to campaign websites and social media accounts. We are currently exploring a collaboration with MapLight, a nonpartisan research organization, to provide more information on candidates for these offices. We produce and distribute a video edition of the voter guide for city elections, hosted on our website and aired on cable television. We strongly believe that empowering voters to cast an informed ballot is critical to the democratic process, and we are supportive of the initiatives that will provide more voters with more information. Together, intro number 255 and intro 504 would significantly expand our voter information mandate. Under Section 203 of the Voting Rights Act, we currently publish the voter guide in five languages: English, Spanish, Chinese, Korean, and Bengali. We also translate transcripts of candidates' video statements into these languages. Under intro 255, we would be required to translate and print the voter guide in the top seven limited English proficiency languages, which would potentially add up to five new language additions to the print guide. This new requirement raises a number of issues to consider. Additional translations will require a significant investment of resources, as some languages are more expensive to translate, format, and print. New language editions will require additional costs for printing and distribution. Our current practice, with permission of the Department of Justice, is to target the mailings of the voter guide in Chinese, Korean, and Bengali to voters by conducting surname analysis and determining areas where the relevant populations are concentrated. The CFB should have the authority to deliver these new resources to the populations that need them. Targeting distribution will mitigate additional translation, printing, and postage costs and ensure voters receive the information that is most relevant to them. Intro number 504 would require the CFB to print and mail voter guides for federal and state elections as well as city elections. We support expanding the voter information resources available to New Yorkers, and we know from feedback we receive that many New Yorkers depend on the print voter guide. Candidate participation rates in the guide have been high, in part because we have a direct relationship with candidates running for city office. 95% of candidates on the ballot in the primary provided information for the guide's print edition, and 74% of the candidates for the general election in 2013. To ensure voters receive information focused on candidates they will see on the ballot, we produced 14 print editions for the 2013 primary election and 20 editions for the general election. Overall, we printed and mailed nearly 7.5 million guides in 2013. Producing, printing, and mailing the guide for the primary and general elections and citywide election years is a significant undertaking, requiring staff to collect and track candidate submissions, review content, communicate with translators, and oversee production at the print and mailing house. In 2013, our budget included nearly $10 million to print and distribute the voter guide. Printing and mailing multiple voter guides every year, including information for federal, state, and county offices, would require a considerable new investment. After intro number 504 was introduced in October of 2014, we estimated that creating guides for the state and federal primaries and the general elections in 2016 could cost between $16 and $28.5 million. Publishing voter guides in 2017 under the expanded mandate to cover additional offices could cost between $19.5 and $35 million. These estimates do not include the necessary cost of additional staff dedicated to the annual production of multiple citywide print voter guides. For example, we anticipate that it would require more staff time just to follow up with candidates to submit their information because we don't have an established relationship. Without this follow-up, we expect lower response rates from candidates for non-city offices, which would make the guides less useful for voters. We are proud of the work we do to inform voters, and we are happy to explore ways we can expand our reach. However, as you consider Intro 504, and as we consider our budget requests for the coming fiscal year, it is important that the City Council is fully aware of the significant investment it requires. Our immediate recommendation would be to amend Intro 504 to eliminate the requirement for the voter guide to cover party positions. There are multiple party position contests per assembly district, and there are easily more than 1,000 candidates across the city for delegate, state committee, county committee, and district leader positions. It is true that there is often little information available to voters about the candidates for these party positions. Still, removing them would simplify the production of the guide, lessen the expense, and ensure the information we provide is the most helpful and meaningful to voters. Omitting party positions would enable us to print fewer editions and dedicate more space to candidates for other offices. Intro number 504 does allow us to reduce some costs by allowing to create an opt-out procedure for voters who prefer to receive the guide electronically. This was among the recommendations on our 2013 post-election report, and we think it is an important tool to providing voters the information that they need in the format they prefer. The most efficient way to create this system would be for the Board of Elections to collect opt-out information at the time of voter registers. At the same time, voters could indicate in which language they prefer to receive the guide. That way, we can ensure voters receive the guide in the correct language, removing some guesswork. We would also like to note that the BOE is continually improving their online poll site locator with lists of candidates and sample ballots, and it's a valuable resource. We would love to work with the BOE to integrate this tool into our online guide so we give voters additional tools prior to Election Day. Of course, there are other ways we could reduce costs for the voter guide. One obvious change would be to consolidate the primaries. Voters will go to the polls at least four times in 2016, which guarantees voter fatigue. Primary consolidation makes imminent sense for everyone involved, especially voters. Fewer elections would relieve the administrative burden on the BOE and would mean fewer editions of the voter guide. We support resolution number 232A to consolidate the primaries and would urge members of the City Council to be even more active in asking the state legislature to act. As you know, we have been working with partners on the Vote Better NY effort to push for voting reform at the state level. We want to ensure that every New Yorker can register to vote, has an opportunity to get to the polls, and can cast a ballot that counts. We strongly support resolution 553, which calls on the state to legislature to pass legislation to allow early voting. We also urge the Council to consider a resolution in support of the Voter Empowerment Act, which would bring our outdated voter registration system into the 21st century by leveraging technology to get more people registered and keep their registrations up to date. We also urge the Council to consider a resolution supporting the Voter Friendly Ballot Act, which would provide voters with clearer, simpler ballots and has unanimously passed the Assembly for three sessions in a row. Finally, we support resolution number 870, asking legislators to change state law so that people with felony convictions be able to register to vote once they are released from prison. Under current law, probationers can complete a voter registration form, but people released to community supervision must wait until they have completed parole to submit a voter registration form. Many would-be voters do not understand the distinction between parole and probation or are unclear about their status. New Yorkers should not feel that they need to disclose their conviction status in order to get clarity on whether or not they can register. Language on the voter registration form explains that it is a crime to furnish false information to the BOE. Some people fear that they could be returned to prison if they complete the form incorrectly. Changing the state law to allow people to register once they have been released from prison would simplify existing policy and make it clear and less frightening to those who have been incarcerated. It would encourage people released to community supervision to take part in civic life as they part of their reentry to society. We support Resolution 281A, which calls on the mayor to create an annual student voter registration day. This year, the CFB, Councilmember Rosenthal, the New York Immigration Coalition, community groups, and other members of the council are partnering to bring SVRD to 56 schools throughout the city. We will bring our message to nearly 20,000 students citywide on March 18th. Last year, on our inaugural SVRD, we registered over 2,000 students in 25 schools. We generally support much of the remaining legislation under consideration today, though we defer to the Board of Elections to assess the administrative burden they represent. We support the remaining items under consideration. Thank you for your time, and I'm happy to take your questions.
Thank you for your extensive testimony and always giving thoughtful testimony, and also for letting members of the public go first. With regards to resolution number 390A, has the Voter Assistance Advisory Committee examined the impact on voter participation among language minorities after the following reforms were put in place: the provision of Spanish, Chinese, Korean, and Bengali interpreters at poll sites, provision of registration forms and voter information in Spanish, Chinese, Korean, Bengali, and Russian, and publication of voter guides in Spanish and Chinese?
I'm not sure if I completely, fully understand your question, but the voter guide information has been provided in Chinese and Spanish for many, many years, and so it's part of our annual voter assistance advisory report to show participation rates for the preceding years. So, to some extent, that is included in that report.
Did it has including Spanish and Chinese improved participation with regards to those language minority groups?
We haven't done a specific study of that. It is true that voter participation remains abysmally low across the entire city in all language groups. So, there's much work to be done.
What are your thoughts on an opt-in option for voter guides in other languages, perhaps through a parse card included in the English voter guide, that voters can return and request voter guides in other languages? So when they get the mailer, it would actually have on the back of it a page in multiple languages offering URLs, or even just call this number, text this message, or send cut out and mail back this form with the checkbox and your return address.
We actually did something very similar to that. and for Asian languages before we did the surname analysis provision. We did an opt-out for cards, and we got a huge response. I mean, it was a very, very successful. So I think that that is a very important way to let people select which languages they want. I think it even better, the city of Los Angeles, the way they do it is they collect that information as part of the voter registration process so that you know as part of your voter record which language you prefer, whether or not you prefer to get the guide in online or in print.
I know that the Center for the Independence of Disabled is also interested in this specific piece. Would you be willing to send along specific language or for what an opt-in would look like so that people can opt in to receiving something in Braille or in the language of their choice?
Okay, we can send you the language that we used for that. I think it was an opt-out, but I think it's just, you know, the language would be similar, so I can set forward that along, the language you used when we did that.
And I don't think I've had a chance to ask you this, and forgive me for asking on the record, but council districts are difficult sometimes to know which side you're on. And I think most people watching or most people don't know which council district they're on or where the borders are. And even so, especially when you're on the border, in my southern border, my southern border ends at 55th or 54th. And so it's 55th between 1st and York and or Sutton and 54th between 1st and 2nd. And as such, knowing where your district is can sometimes be tough. The voter guide gets sent out for Manhattan, for Upper Manhattan, I think Lower Manhattan. And so when somebody gets it, they may not know which people from the voter guide to be looking at. Eric's gonna pull out my voter guide, which is why this matters. And I guess the concern would be whether or not we could do, as opposed to, I imagine, something like 10 voter guides, if we could just do 51 voter guides where you have the templated language and then you end up having a separate voter guide for each one of the council districts.
What we tried to do is to, in order to conserve costs, it's based on printing practices, you know, the size, the appropriate size, you know, the large, certain optimum size for printing conserves costs. But what we do now is, even though each edition of the guide covers more than one city council district, it says right on your address label which council district you're in, so that you know which one you're in.
I never even noticed that.
So it does say which it says, and it actually tells you which election district and assembly district you're in too. It gives you all your voter location information. In addition, of course, as you well know, and I know that's not useful for every voter, but there are many online sources for determining which.
Could the sergeant in arms bring over a copy of the voter guide in question so I can see it? I imagine that if you asked people how many folks look at their mailing label, most people would not.
Yeah.
So I see it here. It is. I let the record reflect that it says it your CD, though most people probably might not know what an CD is, or ADED, also things folks may not know what they are. Unless you are hyper technical and a governmental operations person who comes to our hearings quite often. So I guess I would just say is if you could investigate the cost of how much to just do one of these for each council district instead of grouping them. So in this case, it's Brooklyn Council Districts 33 through 37. So you're grouping four together. So why not just do one offs as opposed to four offs?
But one other thing to point out is that inside the
The sergeant at arms to bring it back.
Inside the, if you want to keep that for a second, I'll just show you. On the inside cover, there is actually a statement that tells you to look at that if you're not sure which council district you live in. So there's a little ad on the inside front cover in blue. Oh, you have a different. That's the general.
Okay, so it says in red.
It's a different color.
Not sure which council district you live on. Check the cover.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, but we can look into that. I mean, we're always looking at ways to improve the formatting of the voter guide. So, but one of the reasons that it's been done this way is to conserve costs.
So the one thing I would just add to that, that we're happy to investigate ways to make that information more prominent on the face of the guide. When we're talking about going from, say, 14 or 20 editions to 51, you know, there are the additional costs. It's not necessarily additional printing costs. It's additional design and layout. It's additional setup. Each time you're setting up a new edition, there's setup costs for the printer. So, again, we haven't specced out those costs precisely, but what we are talking about a significant investment.
I think it's worth it. I'll just say that on my campaign, we micro-targeted to 38,000 households, and we used complex mail merges to identify common interests and items like that. So it's one of those things where if you write intelligent enough documents on the front end, it makes it a little bit easier on the back end. Is there anything that I should have asked that that I did not ask?
No, we'll look into getting you that language for the opt-in, and we'll look into the cost of printing 51.
Thank you. And with regard to the recommendations that you made a year ago, not even a year ago, in 2014, we hope to hear your bills as soon as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to excuse this panel. Our next panel, and I believe this is, so our next panelist will be Rachel Faust from Citizens Union, and I believe she has near perfect attendance. She is excused for maternity leave, and my understanding is that this is our final hearing with Rachel, and we just applaud all the work she's done. I've known her for a very long time, and she's been a stalwart for democracy, and the city is in a much better place having had her. Additionally, sitting, if you guys and gals could please come up, Prudence Katz, formerly of One Good Government Group, now of another, Common Cause New York. Kwame Akosa from Brennan Center, and Kate Doran from League of Women Voters of NYC. It's in order of who shows up most frequently. So it would go Citizens Union, Common Cause, League of Women Voters. If Brennan Center could be here more often, you will get to go higher up in the panel. And we are working hard to make governmental operations and the council as a whole more accessible and open. So we are happy to coordinate with the Good Government groups as to what time we believe you will be here so that we can coordinate the panel, and even if we need to recess so that you can start at a specific time. The Sergeant at Arms will take your testimony. So thank you very much, and we are giving the Good Government groups 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Chair Kallos. Thank you for the introduction. I'm very happy to have my last day as Policy Director of Citizens Union testifying before this committee. It seems appropriate. This has been a large area of my work. Again, I'm the Policy Director for Citizens Union, a nonpartisan good government group dedicated to making democracy work for all New Yorkers. We're pleased to have another hearing of the Council on Election Legislation, as you did last fall. And especially given that 2016 is a very important election year. We've grouped the legislation in approximately three groups, so I'll address each in turn: voter notification, voter education, and then resolutions on state legislation and action by the Board of Elections. On voter notification, ensuring that voters have greater information at their disposal in modern digital formats is a very worthy goal, particularly given our low turnout. Proactive notifications regarding basic election information, such as poll site locations and voter registration dates, could help ensure voters are able to find their poll sites and update their registration. And that's obviously the first step to actually casting a vote, is being registered and finding your poll site. So as such, we support the intent of the legislation today, Intro 62 by Councilmember Gorodnick, about requiring notice of former poll sites. We also support Councilmember Vaca's legislation 463. I believe that was a previous iteration that Citizens Union helped draft with Councilmember Dickens. So this one in particular, we've been very interested in following. Regarding Councilmember Torres's new legislation 848, we think this legislation is a very interesting promising idea. We've done our own research on voting and found that structural voting reforms only get you so far, like election day registration. And research indicates that peer and social pressure is also a very effective tool when done in coordination with those efforts. So providing voters with their history of voting, it could be an interesting way of giving them a little bit of that social pressure and could be an effective tool. I know that something that has been done by NYC Votes is a pledge to voters to commit to go to vote on election day. Getting that back in the mail saying, yes, you yourself committed to vote. This is almost a similar idea, but we think this could be a very interesting experiment for New York City to implement. It could be a significant one. But for all those bills, we do recognize there are fiscal impacts, and the enactment dates might not need to be adjusted. I missed the Board of Elections testimony, but I imagine they spoke to those issues. On the New York City Voter Guide, we've long supported expanding and modernizing the voter guide published by the Campaign Finance Board. And we know that in addition to the legislation 504 and 255, there's another bill which is in the docket of campaign finance tweaks for the campaign finance system. Your bill, Councilmember Kallos, 988, to have an electronic opt-out. We think these bills are best considered together in terms of overall reforms to the voter guide. If you expand to include more information about federal, state races, and translate into additional languages, the electronic opt-out can help to offset some of those costs, which we would understand would be significant. On the intro 504 in particular, we also understand that as drafted, that bill is extremely comprehensive, including district leaders and a number of positions. And we are open to narrowing it to include maybe just basic information about the candidates on the ballot and thinking about which are the races and candidates that greater information could be given to voters about. On the resolutions on state legislation, these mirror, we do a lot of work lobbying at the state level, and we support many of these bills and are actively working on them, in particular consolidating the primary in June. I think it's clear to everybody that four elections is far too many in New York. It's costly, and it also, research indicates that voter fatigue is a very serious problem when voters have to turn out over and over again for elections. We support the resolution to create an annual student voter registration day. We've supported we've worked on that effort in the pilot program, and we've called upon the DOE to make it a permanent program. We also support having half-day shifts for the City Board of Elections. We know that that's been a pilot in Brooklyn, and we support it being expanded citywide. We don't have a specific position on the Russian interpreters resolution in the legislation, primarily because are looking at the issue of accessibility generally. We do support language accessibility for all voters. And on early voting, it's my understanding that the notice has changed, that you are reflecting a different bill from what was previously posted. And obviously the governor's legislation and Assemblymember Kavanaugh's early voting legislation, we both support. And I think the council's right to look. See, there are a lot of competing proposals, so right to look for the one that seems to have the most momentum at the state level. And then finally, we also support the state legislation to allow parolees to vote. This is something that we believe that once parolees have completed their sentence, there should be no impediments to them getting the right to vote. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name is Prudence Katz. I'm Common Causes Research and Policy Manager. We are overall in favor of the 11 bills and resolutions before today's Government Operations Committee. We're not going to speak. I'm not going to speak in detail about all of them. I think my colleague Rachel did a very wonderful job summarizing everything. But we appreciate that individually these bills address the distressing problem of low voter turnout by enhancing different aspects of the voter experience, and taken together will act to streamline the overall process of casting a ballot. Important measures that these bills address include expanding the scope of the voter guide in more languages, bringing voter information in the 21st century through text and email alerts, updating voters with their voting history, ensuring that an individual can get to the correct poll site if their most recent poll site location has moved. And that was something, honestly, I didn't know that was a problem, and I was bringing up to a friend the other day about this upcoming testimony. He's like, oh, that happened to me. I was like, he went to his poll site. There was no notice. He went inside. And it had moved. This is in Crown Heights, and he had to, like, track somebody down. And then by then, he had run out of time to vote. He had to go to work. So apparently this is an issue. So definitely it seems like this would be something, all of these are things that we would like to see addressed. We also want to highlight the resolutions that call on New York State to consolidate our election and primary into one day, allow early voting, and to make student voter registration day an annual day embedded in our calendar, restoring voting rights to parolees, and very much in favor of the Board of Elections to allow poll workers to work half-day shifts. Common Cause New York understands that an unfunded mandate is no help to anyone, which is why we joined the New York Voter Coalition in calling our governor to allocate an election reform budget line in his latest budget. In that vein, we hope to see specific funding allocations from the City Council to the New York City Board of Elections so that translation services, technological communication advances, and other voter access tools can be effectively expanded. At the same time, we call on the New York City Board to accept the direction from the New York City Council, continuing these needed bills and resolutions, and to work with every level of government to ensure that voters can receive the best experience possible. Collaboration and understanding across jurisdictions and municipalities is the key to building up voter participation and will also demonstrate to the people of New York that our government is serious about letting their voices be heard. The council has an obligation to ensure that New York City taxpayer money is spent efficiently and effectively. The obligation carries with it the oversight of the NYC BOE as it receives its taxpayer funding through the City Council. We look forward to working with the council and the CFB and the BOE in implementing these measures. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. So thank you very much for holding this hearing. Thank you for inviting us. I am Kate Doran. I serve on the board of the League of Women Voters. I am what they call their election specialist. We at the League, we're nonpartisan, but we take positions on issues which we believe are important, and we've been in this business for over 95 years promoting voter education, registration, and voter service. So the first couple of things I wanted, we are not commenting on all of the topics that you've that you're addressing today. The first two I'd like to comment on are the resolutions to support New York State Assembly and Senate legislation, and we are strongly in support of early voting, so we'll go on record to support number resolution 553. Resolution number 232, I think the bill numbers were not aligned with what we knew to be the case, but they look to be aligned in the public, in what you gave us this morning, and I've attached a memorandum for our New York State League colleagues, strong support for the Cusick and Stewart Cousins bills that address a consolidated June primary. We have been working for this kind of thing for, I think, since the 1970s, when they got rid of it. Now, as far as Resolution 384 is concerned, this is the one about allowing poll workers to work half-day shifts. I also am a poll worker, so I do know a little bit about this. And we at the League have consistently and vigorously encouraged the board to recruit and to hire inspectors to work half-day shifts. I want to point out that election law permitted the board to do this beginning in March of 2010. So they've had 6 years to try to figure this out and make it happen. And we're a little disappointed, although
I want to congratulate John Flatow, the Brooklyn commissioner, Simon Shamoon, the Republican commissioner from Brooklyn, who took it upon themselves, actually, to make pilot projects happen in November of 2014 and November of 2015. And they were successful, and the problems that the board anticipated did not come to pass. And I think that they do have some serious administrative problems that surround payroll, which kind of surprised me. So perhaps there will be people on the council who could help them solve those problems, because the benefits are just really would very much outweigh the difficulties in making all this happen. So I also want to encourage you in your title to strike the word allow, because they've had permission. They've been allowed to do this since 2010. And instead, replace it with the words, with the phrase, actively develop plans to recruit and hire poll workers. So be it resolved that the City Council calls on the Board of Elections to actively develop plans to recruit and hire poll workers to work half-day shifts. We agree with everything that you've said, all the whereases in your resolution, except that the full-day shift is a minimum of 16 and a half hours on the lowest turnout election day. And because 5 a.m. to 9 p.m. is 16 hours, and there's a lot of work to do after 9 p.m. So that's that. As far as expanding the voter guide, our league has tremendous concerns about this, apart from the cost and the burden on the taxpayers. We believe that expanding the guide will create the impression that the candidates for office are participating in the campaign finance program, which is not the case. So that's a serious concern of ours. But we do wholeheartedly support the establishment of procedures which will allow people to opt out of receiving that printed guide. So lastly, Intro 62A, which we support. I know the Board of Elections is a little, they're not thrilled with this one. And they probably, I don't know if they mentioned it this morning, but they do, of course, send out a notification to all registered voters every year in early August. That's a requirement of New York State election law. The notification must include the name of their poll site, the address of the poll site. It has to tell them when there will be elections that are going to happen. And they do go out of their way to create additional postcards and notices when there is a poll site change that happens after that notice that goes out in August. But here I've got a little prop for you. Here's the notice to voters. This is the one that I got last year in August, and there were only two elections. There was the September and the November. But you can see that it almost looks like a supermarket flyer. And it is first class mail, but it's not stamped, and many voters toss it out, thinking of it, it looks like junk mail. Unfortunately, I'm sure it's very expensive to produce, but voters are not looking at this. So we don't think that the added signage, the requirement for signage, is a big deal. But it would be a huge service to voters, because the number one problem that we have at the poll sites in terms of angry voters is they stand in line, they get up to the information desk or they get to their ED table, and they say, I'm not going to vote now. I don't have time. I think one of my colleagues here mentioned this. I can't go to this other poll site. And they're furious, and they don't understand. And I think that showing up around the corner where they think they're supposed to vote and seeing a sign, that would be a tremendous service to the voters. And I don't think there would be operational issues, but no big deal. So the other thing is, your intro, I believe, asked them to do it for 4 years back. Maybe not 4 years. Maybe you could say 2 years or so. So give them a little break in that way. Because I know there are going to be a lot of changes associated with compliance with the ADA laws. So I can't speak specifically, but the last thing I would say is that most voters don't know their EDs. So if they knew their ED, they would probably have this notice to voters in hand, and they wouldn't have shown up at the wrong poll site. So I think a better thing to be on this poster that's on the building would be maybe a little schematic map that just shows the boundaries of the boundaries of the streets and the neighborhoods, and they say if you live on one of these streets, go to this school around the corner. If you live on these streets, go to that church over there. But the EDs, and the EDs change often also, so I think that might be a little bit harder. But one last thing. On the invitation we received, I didn't have the resolution from Councilmember Rosenthal, so I haven't had any chance to study that. But it looks and sounds like something that with some attention, we would probably be generally in support of. So thank you very much. I really appreciate being able to be here.
Thank you and good afternoon. My name is Kwame Okosa, and I work at the Brennan Center for Justice in the Democracy Program at that center. Today I'll be speaking briefly about Resolution 870 and Resolution 553 in support. I will talk about each in that order. The Brennan Center for Justice at NYU School of Law thanks the members of the Committee on Government Operations for the opportunity to share testimony at today's hearing on Resolution 870, which calls upon the New York State Legislature to pass Bill A7634, a bill restoring voting rights for people with criminal convictions in their past. The Brennan Center has a particularly long record of supporting reforms to efforts to reform criminal disenfranchisement laws at the state and federal levels. The Brennan Center has published a series of reports on voting rights restoration and provided support to legislative reform efforts throughout the country. Most recently, the center was involved in efforts supporting Maryland legislation restoring voting rights to people released from incarceration, which was passed earlier this month. Bill A7634 would restore voting rights to 40,000 New Yorkers who are on parole and are now living and working in our communities. Accordingly, it would also require the state to notify individuals when a criminal conviction will result in the loss of voting rights, as well as when the right to vote is eventually restored. It would also require the provision of voter registration forms at the time an individual is released from incarceration. Supporting the passage of this legislation is good public policy for the following reasons. First, rights restoration serves public safety. Resolution number 870 correctly notes that restoring voting rights for people with criminal convictions who are now living and working in our communities will promote community reintegration and civic engagement. Parole and probation professionals agree. The American Probation and Parole Association has stated that disenfranchisement laws work against successful reentry, and research reinforces this view. Studies have found consistent differences between voters and non-voters in rates of subsequent arrests, incarceration, and self-reported criminal behavior. Second, the rights restoration will reduce the disproportionate disenfranchisement of minorities. As Resolution number 870 correctly identifies, New York's incarcerated population is disproportionately minority, which means that the communities in which these individuals reside are disproportionately disempowered by criminal disenfranchisement laws. In research conducted for a 2010 report, the Brennan Center found that nearly 80% of those who have lost their right to vote under New York's disenfranchisement laws are African American or Latino, and that New York disenfranchisement laws has historical roots in a concerted effort to exclude African Americans from participating in the political process. As detailed in our report, Jim Crow in New York, at the very time that the 14th and 15th Amendments forced New York to remove its nefarious property requirement for African American voters, New York changed its law requiring the disenfranchisement of those convicted of infamous crimes. Today, New York's disenfranchisement law is nearly identical to that provision enacted 140 years ago. Third, rights restoration will reduce confusion and administrative burden. Bill A7634 is also an important step towards addressing the unnecessary confusion caused by New York's current law, which arbitrarily denies voting rights to people on parole but not on probation. A Brennan Center study revealed that more than a third of New York's local election boards incorrectly state that people on probation are ineligible to vote. Restoring voting rights to individuals once they exit incarceration is an easier to administer policy that will eliminate the opportunity for mass dissemination of inaccurate and misleading information, which could lead to the de facto disenfranchisement of eligible would-be voters. And finally, across the country, there is considerable momentum towards restoring voting rights to individuals with criminal convictions, fueled by a growing bipartisan consensus that restoring voting rights is a smart-on-crime policy that strengthens our democracies and communities. Over the past two decades, more than 20 states have taken action to allow more people with past criminal convictions to vote sooner, or to access that right more easily. Bill A7634 provides a valuable opportunity for New York to participate in this movement to help individuals reintegrate into society and to encourage civic participation to correct and to correct historically unjust laws and reduce harm caused by confusing and burdensome disenfranchisement laws. We therefore urge the City Council to pass Resolution 870. And briefly on the early voting, we also urge the Council to pass Resolution 553. In past elections, including most recently the 2012 election, New York's voters have had to endure long lines on election days in order to cast a ballot. With dozens of states, while dozens of states allow early in-person voting, New York only allows voters who cannot be present on election day to cast an absentee ballot if such voter meets designated qualifications. Bill A689, which Resolution 553 urges the state to pass, will allow all New Yorkers to have the opportunity to have their voice heard without waiting in long lines. Early voting offers 21st century voters the convenience and flexibility that match the demands of modern life. As discussed in the Brennan Center's report, Early Voting, What Works, early voting has added the added election administration benefits of reducing the stress on the voting system on election day, shortening lines on election day, improving poll worker performance, and allowing for early identification and correction of registration errors and voting system glitches. Lastly, our research has shown that early in-person voting is an unquestionably popular practice that boosts voter satisfaction and confidence in the electoral system. For these reasons, the Brennan Center urges the City Council to pass number 553. Right on time. I use the website.
So the first question for this panel is, Rachel, how long have you been at
at Citizens Union? This is about just over 8 years, so it's been working on these issues for a long time, and appreciated working with this council for the last, I guess, 3 years now.
2 years, 1 month, and 29 days.
Okay. I can't count, excuse me.
It's okay. That being said, I'd like you, if Sergeant-at-Arms will humor me, I'd like to present you with a citation from the city. Aww. Where is a great city, come on over, where is a great city is only as great as those persons who give exemplary service to their communities, whether through participation in voluntary programs, through unique personal achievement in their professional or other endeavors, or simply through a lifetime of good citizenry. And whereas such service, which is truly the lifeblood of the community and the city, so often goes unrecognized and unrewarded, now therefore be it resolved that as a duly elected member of the New York City Council, we recognize that in Rachel Foss, we have an outstanding citizen, one who is worthy of the esteem of both the community and the great city of New York, and witness whereof I here have hereunto set my hand. New York City Council Member Ben Kallos, thank you.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure to work with you.
Thank you. We still have lots of things to get done, but I would just say that Citizens Union has been working on corruption in government for, I think, over a century, and it was under your leadership that outside income went out the door, Lulu's went out the door, rules reform, member item funding reform, a lot of things that we've been able to do together in just 2 years, 1 month, and 29 days. Hopefully we will continue to get these things done. I think with regard to Kate Doran's comment on the poll site, I think Prudence spoke to it, which is just most people only vote once every 4 years. And this coming election is that one time that they will be voting every 4 years, most likely just in November. And in so doing, when poll sites have been moved once, twice, three times, or even eight times, people will not know that. All they'll know is that this is the poll site I voted at for the past 40 or 100 years, and that sometime in the last four years. So we are good at giving the notice when it's just been moved, but if it's been moved any time since the last presidential election, I think that's what we're trying to cover. With regard to language access, is it important that we, in terms of, for this panel, do you think we should just print it in every single language or allow people to opt in to specific languages? What is the best way to deal with the voter guide and making sure more people have access?
Well, I think from Citizens Union's perspective, we're definitely aware there are administrative issues with with producing a guide that is very tailored. So I think you said it rightly that there should be some level of the voter acknowledging what they would personally like. I think having the opt-out makes a lot of sense, and there could also it could also be coupled with a system of voters signing up for the language that they would like. I think the only issue is that you would want to recognize that not every voter is going to affirmatively do that. So there could be some level of targeting based on the information that is known by the campaign finance board, but then updating that information on a regular basis.
With regard to consolidation of primaries, should that be June? Should that be August? Should it be, I think some people would love to have it on like 4th of July when no one else is gonna show up. when should we consolidate the primary, and how many years have folks been advocating, since the 70s?
Well, there was a single June primary back in the 70s.
If you can say that into the mic, thank you.
Back in the 1970s, there was a single June primary. And I don't know, my colleagues who've been around that long and working for the league could tell you perhaps why, what happened. But it makes sense. It makes sense before people go away for the summer. It's not usually tremendously hot inside those school rooms, so you can, you don't have to worry about air conditioning and that sort of thing. That's a trivial matter. But single June primary, we've been strongly supportive and pushing for this for a long time.
With regard to voter histories, do you believe that there would be any impact to voters seeing that their voter history is public information? The Daily News spoke today about having grades. Do you think that having A through F grades or some other indicator of performance would be helpful?
I know the Common Cause is not for the grades. From what I understood with the bill, Councilmember Torre's bill was that... Just voter history, and it was going to said voter. We think that this is a good idea. It will be a way to show potentially what they had been missing out on and they didn't realize. It could be seen as, the same way as getting your meter read or getting a credit score, just like these important audits that don't necessarily think about that often. And we think that it could be a useful educational tool, but we definitely don't want to have any sort of shaming aspect to it.
Yeah, I would echo what Prudence said. I think, we looked at the bill as drafted with the voter history. And, I would say the closest corollary that we know of in terms of the literature is around pledging to vote and, social and peer pressure. And I think it kind of would be sufficient as is for a voter to receive. There is an element of pressure knowing that to see a blank, if you will, on your voting history. I think having a grade might be a little unnecessary in that way, but I think the important thing is for the voter to have the information, because they may have missed the election because they weren't aware of it, it slipped their mind, or they may not realize that not turning out to vote 1 year, maybe they haven't realized it was multiple years that they haven't voted. So, I think the issue of how far back to go is raised. The only issue I would say with maybe sticking to the 4 year time period is that's the presidential election cycle, and that's when more voters are apt to turn out. So the 4 year period from that perspective makes sense to me.
Would it be helpful to have elections? So perhaps we could have elections where you turn out, and then we could have elections missed so people could actually see the opportunities that they missed?
And that could be interesting.
Okay. In terms of text messaging notifications, do you anticipate that would be difficult to do? Are there other technologies that currently have it? I know panelists coming up will want to speak to that because they've been working on that for a while, but do any other states do this? Is it just something that Rock the Vote does? Anyone speak to text message notifications?
At the commissioner's meeting on Tuesday, Executive Director Ryan mentioned that there are, 4 point something million registered voters, And he said, the problem is they only have captured about 100,000 emails. And there is a field on the registration form to include an email address, but it's optional, and people change their emails. I'm looking forward to hearing about how it could be implemented. I think it's a very good idea, but it seems like, you know, I don't know how quickly it could be done. And going forward, I think it's something that is important and should be pursued, but it's going to be hard.
Thank you very much.
I just want to quickly add that I understand New Jersey does some form of text message notification. So during Hurricane Sandy, for example, when some poll sites were underwater so folks couldn't vote, there actually were text message notifications sent out about poll sites being moved. So there are precedents in other states. I do agree that collecting email information is onerous, but I think once folks understand that, then they'll get reminders, or if putting their text, their right. number down, they'll get reminders, I think that will increase participation.
Thank you very much, this panel, and thank you for your patience, and thank you for your 8 years of service, and Paul brought you a cardboard frame for your citation. Thank you. Our final panel is Seth Flaxman from Democracy Works, also known as TurboVote. Get your app today. New York Immigration Coalition, Aber K, and also from New York Immigration Coalition, Murad. Murad A. You should have three people on the final panel. Do we have anyone from New York Immigration Coalition? Okay.
Okay.
I believe they have submitted testimony for the record, and Seth, that's all
Thank
you.
Thank you. Happy to be the anchor on your marathon session. Chair Kallos, thank you.
If you would like to come for marathon, please join us for our budget hearing on March 14th. We will be starting at 9:30 and going past 5.
On my calendar. So thank you for allowing me the opportunity to testify. My name is Seth Flaxman. I'm the co-founder and executive director of Democracy Works. We're a nonprofit that builds technology to make voting easier. And for those who don't know about us, one of our services is probably the most used, even though people don't know we're behind it, that you may have used is in the 2014 cycle, and since then, the Pew Charitable Trust has contracted with us to work with states and counties to collect polling place election data and standardize it into a national data set. We then coordinate with Google so voters can search where do I vote online and find the correct polling place. We also run a website, TurboVote, that allows any American to sign up once and get help registering to vote, voting absentee, and important to this, receiving text and email notifications with reminders of election dates. So since we launched this in 2010, we've learned a lot about how difficult it is to send text and email notifications. We're encouraged by the results we've seen that simply reminding our users of upcoming elections can spur them into checking their registration status and making sure they have a plan to vote. The idea of a government sending election reminders or notifications perfectly represents the driving notion and mission behind our work, that voting should fit the way we live. I don't have to tell you that we're increasingly living on our mobile devices, and we expect to have information at our fingertips. And so I'd like to share some of the lessons we've learned as we've tried to meet voters where they are, especially as it relates to the email and text message proposal. So first, it's hard to know exactly what about a notification tool is going to work until you start building it. So I would say it's important to allow room for changes and adjustments. This is in reference to the 10-day out rule. I recommend testing and iterating on the design of a system without excessive initial prescription. This can sometimes lead to finding out answers you didn't know you were looking for, and given the public nature of notifications and the highly customizable content in each message, ensuring perfect implementation from start to finish can be a challenge on a rushed timeline. Second, I would encourage a more iterative approach. The number of users and the stakes for success go up dramatically in a presidential year like 2016. So the development or rollout of a notification system can be crucial to its overall success. It would be best if a system were phased in over time rather than released all at once. There are many ways to implement these types of notifications, so having the ability to try different approaches in smaller sizes over time allows control for errors and an ability to fix problems more quickly. And then finally, I highly recommend a concern for privacy serve as a thorough line for the development of any election notification system. Moving quickly to build technology where personal information is concerned is always tricky. And we've witnessed other states and cities where not thinking about privacy has become an implementation problem later down the line. Not that it should stop you, but important to think through it up front. Specifically around how you want access to emails and text messages as they get added to the public record. That all said, I'm always encouraged when I see government willing and eager to make the act of civic engagement easier. Chair Kallos, you've been a leader on this since you came on the council 2 years, 1 month, and 9 days? 20 days ago.
28 days and 14 hours and 2 minutes.
28 days and 14 hours.
I had to say 29, but.
I think these efforts are great, will give us a better democracy. I heartily endorse election notifications. And I hope our years of experience working in this area can serve you and the council as this issue moves forward. Thank you, and look forward to answering any questions.
Sure. I think key thing, just being from the legislation, it's very prescriptive. It just says providing specific notifications. It doesn't even provide for methods for signing up. I know that we're building a voter information portal as part of a previous hearing at which you testified, where I think we'll be relying extensively on your technology. So I guess given the fact that we've spent over a year negotiating the voter information portal, how easy do you believe it will be to build into a system for absentee ballot tracking and that will already have email notification and whatnot, since we're already building a system for absentee ballot tracking, mm-hmm. How difficult will it be to add email notification, text message notification, voter information, et cetera?
I think it's not a challenge to do, technically speaking. It's really about can you roll it out in mass before the 2016 presidential election and make sure you've built in time to check for errors. And as you know, with your background in software, the best way to build stable systems is to iterate them and roll them out over time. And so for me, the question would be, what would be the right goal for this presidential election? That's not full rollout of the full vision of everything we want to do, but a way to get rolling so that we have a good first step. So for example, that might include the board has 100,000 emails already, so maybe it's running a test with those emails to see what's the most effective message they could send to the group they already have emails for, and at the same time figuring out how we're going to start collecting the email and mobile numbers this cycle, so that by the time we get to the mayoral next year, we have a larger group that could get messages. I hope that addressed the question.
Legislation moves fast. I'm not sure whether or not we'll be able to make it happen for this coming presidential. I think hopefully this is about building a base for the next election.
Great.
Do you believe that showing somebody their voter history will have an impact on their turnout behavior?
Yes. The academic literature does support that idea. And where it's backfired, though, in the past is when organizations voters are not familiar with showed them their records, and so it's they thought it was creepy. But I think it coming from a government entity makes perfect sense because people feel, you know, that's the entity that has authority over the voter rolls.
Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you very much for coming out, for joining us through a longer than usual or expected hearing. Usually we do these at 1 o'clock and they go till 5, so 4 hours doesn't seem as long. Today we started at 10 and went till 2, so it's still our regular hearing. I just want to thank my committee counsel, Smita Deshmukh, as well as Lori Wen for bearing with me. I take full responsibility for the solution we ended up arriving at with regards to translation servicing. Our preference would have been to have a professional translation service that was able to deal with some of the technical terms, but glad we did have a volunteer from the community. It is not ideal, and moving forward, we will be doing our best, because our goal is to have continued meetings with continued community presence in as many languages as are spoken in this great city, and simultaneous translation services to support all of them. With that being said, I'll excuse this panel and hereby adjourn this meeting.
Thank you.